Okay, then let's start. First of all, thank you for attending this workshop in spite of these difficult times. By difficult times, I meant this online semester. So yeah, thank you for attending, and yeah, let's get straight away to the content. So before we start, since this is a new scenario for both of us, online workshop where we need hands-on, so we have decided temporary flow. Hope it works well. So there will be periodically after subtopics, we will hold some doubt sessions so that we can clear your doubts. And while presentation is going on, you may get some doubts, and it is likely that you will forget them. So if you get any doubt during presentation, just put them in the meeting chat, and yeah, we will discuss that them in the doubt session that we have after a few subtopics. And we will try our best to clear all the doubts in the during the doubt session. However, due to time constraints, if we are unable to resolve some of the doubts, we are happy to stay even after the workshop ends, like even after 5:30, and help you. So yeah, we will try our best to resolve queries. And one more important instruction which we request you to follow from your side is during hands-on sessions, we request you to follow along on your system also, like along with me, you also do it so that you also get the feel of version control. So yeah, first it's kind of a prerequisites Linux commands. So let's directly get on to the terminal. So if you are on Linux or Mac, open the terminal, or if it's Windows, Git bash is preferred. Like I opened, this is a Git bash which you get by typing in the Windows command. So in Windows, you might have got habituated of using folders. Like what do? You open a folder or directory and check the directory inside and see what files are there. Open the file using a file editor, write them and save. So the basic now the aim of the current is to discuss those term do those things using terminal. So first of all, in Linux we call everything as directory. It's not folder anymore. So like in GUI, like in Windows or others, simply you can know where you are by simply this path. Like now currently I know that I'm in /user/Raghavendra Kaushik. Now on this black screen, how do I know? So there's a simple command for that, which is pwd, which stands for print working directory. So see, that results out where I am. So I'm in /user/Raghavendra Kaushik. So if I want to know what are the contents of my directories, like what are the contents here, I can see them using icons since this is a graphical user interface. And on this terminal, you need to list the contents. So it's basically ls to list the contents of your directory. And here you get all those folders and files that are in your directory, that are in your current directory, to be clear. So let's clear the terminal. And suppose after seeing the contents, suppose once again you want to move to one of the directories. So basically you want to change your directory. So suppose I want to move to desktop directory. In GUI, I would simply click on desktop and get its access. In terminal, we do ch like for to change directory, it's simply cd and name of the directory. So to verify that I am in desktop, you can see here this thing has changed, and obviously you can do a verification using pwd command. So yeah, now suppose you have moved to desktop and you want to go back. To go back one level, like currently you are at /c/user/Raghavendra Kaushik/desktop, and you want to go back one level, which is /c/user/Raghavendra Kaushik. You do cd dot dot. What has happened? Yeah, sorry for that. So yeah, I'll repeat it. So if you want to go back one level, you do cd dot dot, so that you go back. So let's move to desktop and list the contents. So there are too many things, like for too many files and directories. So if you want to make your own folder or make your own directory, I should say. Hello, huh?
Your screen has probably been frozen.
Screen frozen?
Yeah.
Where am I? Like,
no, it is visible for me.
It's already for me also, it's working.
Okay, let me do screen share once again. So is the terminal visible now?
Yes.
Cool. So yeah, now you are in the desktop directory and you want to suppose now make your own directory, make your own folder. So for that, it's make your own directory. It's shortened as mkdir, which stands for make directory, and name of your directory, suppose workshop. So now you want to move to the directory. So what you do, you do git workshop, and suppose you want to make folder and set folder. So mkdir, suppose you make folder name secrets and you move to secrets, and now you make another directory secrets and you move to secrets. Now suppose you want to go back home, then typing cd dot 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 dot, this would be a great pain. So to go home, cd is the simple command to go to your home. So before it was desktop slash workshop slash secret slash secrets. Now after cd, you get back to your home. So let's go to, by the way, you know, need not type the whole name of the folder every time, by typing half a part of the string name of the directory and pressing tab, it does its automatic string matching and you get the name. So cd, let's go to here. And yeah, we have been talking about only directories. Now let's talk about making files. So if I want to create a file, so in GUI, what would I do? I would simply, where's the workshop folder? I would simply right click and use this thing. So in terminal, this is really easy. So just use a command called touch and name of the file, say sample.txt. So yeah, that creates an empty file. Again, you can check the contents of the directory by ls command. So you have your sample.txt, which is created. Now, what's the use of an empty file that's created? So let's write something to files. So in general, to write on terminal, use something called echo. Echo is something like, you can think of print your in your favorite programming language. So echo hello generally writes hello. Now you want this hello to be written in a file, then you put a rightward arrow and you put your file name like sample.txt. So now you have it, this command writes, this command prints hello in sample.txt file. So now how do you verify that? In GUI, you would open the file in a simple text editor, but there's a simple command for that again. Cat is the way to read the contents of your file. So cat, your file name, will list out what's in the file. So now suppose you want to add more lines to your file, like suppose you want to write hi and you do cat. It has overwritten when you use single arrow, but you wanted to add a new line. So to add a new line, you simply put double arrow, a double greater than symbol, or I should say, then sample.txt, and now you do cat. So I think it's clear up till now. I will just revise once again. To create empty file, touch and file name. To write something, echo and again file name. and to check the content cat with the file name. So these are the basic commands. And suppose let's you want to delete, then it's simply rm sample.txt. So this is for removing. So I think I've covered most of them. I think most of them are covered. So yeah, so let's get to the content. So hope the prerequisites are clear. So these slides are already uploaded in the GitHub repo, so you can have them for reference, and these are pretty regularly used, so you'll get habituated the more you continue to work. So yeah, let's get to the content. What's exactly Git? So Git is a software which is simply used to track your projects. So by tracking, what does it mean? So suppose it helps you have a backup of your project. Suppose you're working on a project and it has some hundreds of files and you accidentally deleted some of them. So and you even deleted them from your recycle bin. So if your project or direct repo project was tracked by something like Git, you can easily have a backup even if the folders or files are deleted from recycle bin also. And maintain a history of changes. By that I mean, humans have a poor memory. We don't remember what we did yesterday. So with something like Git, you can track at what stage of development what changes were done and who did it, what was done. You can compare the differences between them and experiment without worries. Obviously no one can't be good at first attempt, so to obviously safely experiment on your code base, what you do, you make a copy of it, then experiment, then you will have to make a copies of multiple project if you want to do multiple experiments. So with something like Git, with few commands, you can hop onto a virtual copy of code base, and with just a single command, you can merge those changes in your main copy of their code base. And one more useful feature is to collaborate effectively. By that, as we said, Git tracks when the changes were made in the project. It is also helpful in tracking who did who and when were these changes done. Like Git is so powerful that you can even in a single file, you can even run a command like called git blame and know who was responsible for this line. So yeah, in effective blaming. So basically class of such softwares which track your project and provide all the features which I called are called version control systems, and Git is the most popular among one. So let's once simplify the idea of version control system. So in your machine, you have a folder. And if I ask you to show how that folder looked 6 months back or a year back, you won't be able to show it. In fact, you won't be able to show it how that folder looked few days back. So because that only tracks the most recent changes. So the idea of version control system software is to track what changes have been made to the project at different stages. So why this is useful? By building any software is not a straightforward process. There are many different files, in each file different lines written by different people, then different approaches. So it is really important that you meticulously track what is going on and who did those changes. And even after doing that, if someone still messes up the code base, you should be able to go back to a safer version of the project so that you can keep the code in the project in working. So in code bases or software development, Git is a must. So that's the importance of Git. So we told you what Git does, but how does it track? So generally Git tracks by taking snapshots of your project at different stages. So what does this snapshot of project means? So by snapshot means Git stores how your files of the project look at different stages of development. So this taking snapshot is something done by an action called committing. So when you want to save a snapshot of your project, that means when you want to save how your files look at this stage of development, you do something called commit. A commit is something you can refer as a summary of changes you made to the project, made to your project with reference to previous snapshot. So a commit has a readable, human readable message, like you can see one here, and it has a hash. You can think of it as an Aadhaar number of a commit, maybe not. So yeah, so basically the idea is when you code or work something on few files, you make changes, you take snapshots of how the files look at that stage, and you keep continue doing that. So a simple example would be to suppose you are writing a book, you are an author, and a book is in a suppose a folder, and for the first chapter you wrote in several files and you want to save how the files look. So you commit it after first chapter have been written, then afterwards you proceed to a second chapter, and then again you, after completing the second chapter, you take a commit, you make a commit, that means you save snapshot, which means how the all the files look after second chapter has been written. Then again after you write third chapter, you again commit, that means you save a snapshot of how all your files look after third chapter or the climax chapter has been completed. Now suppose you are not satisfied with the climax chapter and you want to go back to a stage how the files were at second chapter. Basically you want to be at the end of second chapter. So one simple option, so with Git you can just run a single command and go back to a the stage where all your files, how all your files looked at completion of second chapter. So just a small meme on how life would be without something called a version control. So this subversion is just another version control system. So the basic idea lies between first and the last one. With Git, you intelligently write commands and track it in a systematic way. If not, you need to have multiple copies, like final, then final, final, final for this time, then okay, this time real final. So just an old meme, but still relevant. So before we get on to hands-on, we want you to understand the theoretical or a useful mental model so that it makes sense when you write a Git command. So we don't want you to feel like you are typing some gibberish commands. So to make sense what it means when you write commands, this is a useful mental model. So basically in Git there are your files of your project are in three stages. One is working directory, other is staging area, other is repository. So working directory is where you make changes, and repository, if your files are in repository stage, it means the snapshots of the files have been saved. So after making changes and before taking snapshot of the files, in middle there is something called a staging area. So you don't directly make changes in those files and take a snapshot. So before you take the snapshot, I think from now on I will say commit, so that it will be more relevant. So before you commit, in middle there's something called a staging area where you mark your files that these are the files I want to take snapshot of. For example, you make changes in some 10 or 20 files and you want to only finalize or save or commit only few 4 to 5 files. So in that case, you add those 4 to 5 to the staging area and then you commit. So basically the snapshot is taken only of how those 4 to 5 files looked, ignoring the changes made in other 15 or 16 files. So that's the idea. So basically, to summarize, you are in your working directory, you make changes in few files, and if that you add those files in the staging area which you seem are good to save or commit, then after once you add those them to the staging area, you commit. That means you store a snapshot of changes of how your files look. So a short demo so that you get an idea of what's happening. So let's make a directory called Git demo. So let's move to the folder. So this is a completely empty folder. Now suppose I want Git to track this project. So first, to tell Git to track this project, I need to do git init. So by this I tell, hey Git, you are going to track this project. So it means whatever I make changes in this folder, Git is going to track those changes. So I do git init. So yeah, it gives this message. So you can see still it's empty, but see, in Linux and there's something called hidden files which start with dot. So you can access them using ls minus a. So if you see, there's an, after I did git init, there's a secret folder called git dot git. So it is in dot git that all this magic happens, where it stores the versions of files. So this is how you can find verify that okay, git has this project is being tracked by git. Okay, now there's another useful command called git status, which tells you what has been done, like what stage you are, whether you are in staging area, what stage are your files are, what files are in staging area, what stage or is it, have you committed. So if I type git status now, it says on branch master. Okay, we'll come to this later. And it says nothing to commit, create or copy files. So yeah, let's do that. Copy file, let's create a file called demo file and write something to it. And now let's see what git status tells us. So it tells that okay, there are some files that have been untracked. It means files are in the working directory area. So to add them to the staging area, that means before taking a snapshot, as I said, I need to add them in the staging area. So I do that using git add and name of the file, which is demo. So now if I see git status, it shows something different, that it shows green. By green, it tells that these files are in the staging area and you can commit them. So by committing, the command to commit is git commit. So this minus m stands for adding a message. So as I said, every commit is accompanied by a message. So after git commit minus m, you write a meaningful sentence which tell you what changes you have done till now. Like in the book example, I've showed you that completed first chapter, completed till second chapter, completed till third chapter. So a commit message should give you an idea that what changes have been done till this stage. So I added a demo file with some content. It has been committed. That means Git has saved this version and Git knows how the files look at, and I can come back to this stage at every time, even after 10-15 years off, and there have been other hundreds or thousand files have been added. So let's check what git status has to tell. So this is what it generally gives when there's nothing called files, are when no files are in staging area, no files are in working directory. So once all the files have been committed, this is the message you get, on branch master, which will come soon, and nothing to commit working tree clean. So yeah, nothing to commit working tree clean means yes, till the changes you have made, those versions have been saved by git, continue to work. So there are no files that are in staging area, no files that are in working directory. So yeah, all the versions have been saved, you can continue to work. This is what nothing to commit working tree clean means. So, and if you want to know what commits have been done, like in that picture I showed you, first finish the climax, completed first chapter, there's something called git log which lists all the commits. Here there is one. So it shows one commit, it shows okay the message, the hash, as I told, it's like a unique identifier of the commit, as I said, and the author, mail ID, that you have configured with git, and when it was done with timestamp. So yeah, this was a basic demo. We'll come to it. We'll make sure that this idea gets grilled with you with another hands-on. So before that, there is one idea which we want to get cleared. That is staging a sorry that is the staging area. So we found that in our previous workshops many people got confused with staging area, and this is something non-intuitive and still many people get confused. So we thought this analogy would be helpful. So consider you are going to a supermarket, and what do? You select some items and you purchase them. So it's something like an analogous scenario which I want to create is you make changes in files, like which is equivalent to selecting items in market, and you store the commit, you commit in Git, which means saving the versions or taking the snapshots. So between these two, there is this shopping trolley or shopping cart. So before you go take your items to the commit billing counter, you add what you want to purchase to this shopping trolley, shopping cart. So you can visualize the staging area as the shopping cart before you commit. So you make changes, that is you select items, you add the files in the staging area, or you add the items in the shopping cart, and you commit. That means you go to the bill counter and finish the billing, or you save the snapshot by Git commit. So I hope this staging area is helpful to clear, would clear some of your doubts. Now we want to kind of drill this idea, as I said, of Git add commit, Git add commit. So let's have a demo hands-on. So let me first come out of this directory, Git demo, and I want you also to open your terminals and try this parallelly. I'll be going slow only. So hope you are ready. So let's first make a directory called Facebook clone. Okay, and let's change the directory by cd. Okay, now I am in Facebook clone. So now this is an empty repository. Let's tell Git to start tracking. Git init. So it has started. So in normal scenario, like let's so what we want to show you is, so in generally while building a software, what you do is you work on a certain feature. So you basically save snapshots after the feature has been done and or important sub feature has been completed. So in Facebook clone, we want to kind of give you that feel. So so what we do is let's make some features called home page or login logout, and with by making features, I mean just let's create a file and let's add a single content pretending we have completed the feature. So we thought of actually making some proper project, but then time would be wasted in writing semicolons, curly braces, indenting spaces. So this is a Git workshop, so we don't want you to focus on code part rather than main on the Git part. So if someone is not comfortable with writing files and making files in command line, you can simply use GUI and open in your favorite text editor. Like if you are, like most of you might have been using the VS Code editor, you can do simply code dot to open if VS Code is installed. Okay, VS Code has opened. Or if not through terminal, I think this you are familiar, but still let me. You can open with an editor. Like you can open with some other. If you have Sublime or Atom, then that's fine. So basically, let me work. Okay, why are all nets not? So yeah, I have opened Facebook clone in VS Code. So let's make first the home page. It means homepage.txt. I could have done that equivalently by typing touch home page. So not the equivalent GUI part. So let's make the feature. This is the home page of FB clone, and let's now let's now make another feature called, this time through terminal, called login, and let's write something called this is login feature in login page. Let's check the contents of each okay fine. Now let's check git status. Okay, it says there are two files which have been untracked, you need to add them to the staging area. So it has also mentioned commands. So what you can do is git add, one file was login, other file was homepage.txt. Now in general you don't make in just two files. In reality you have to make change in some 4 to 5 files which you can't even keep track of. So this is a big pain to see what files you have made changes in. So in general there's a shortcut. Instead of explicitly mentioning the file names, you can simply write a minus and capital A to add all the files that have been changed. So this is the equivalent of login homepage.txt, and if other files have also been made, then those files too. So since I don't want to write all those files, I simply write git add minus A. So let's do this. This is just a warning due to text editor thing. Nothing related to git, trust me. If you are working in Linux or Mac, this won't pop up. And even if it pops up, this is not an issue. This is not something related to git. So don't worry. And git status. See, as I said, something in green, then it means the files have been added to staging area. One second. Someone's has muted, or why am I hearing some voice? As a Priyanshu bhai. Okay, sir. Then. So yeah, git status tells you how files. So yeah, after git status, you get this green thing which tells, okay, now two files have been added to staging area, and now you are ready to commit them. So git commit minus m with a neat message to tell what you have done. Home page and login features have been added. So let's clear and let's check git status. Yeah, working tree clean. Let's check the commits. Okay, there's only one commit. So kind of let's do this for another two features. One, let's create settings.txt and write settings. Are done settings feature to the file settings settings.txt, and let's create this time using GUI so that kinds of people can follow. And suppose I want to add feature of chats, chat.txt, and this is going to be chat fee. Now suppose we have made changes in now settings and chat.txt files. Let's see git status, which it will be apparent. And now you have completed somehow settings part and chat part, you are not yet sure. You want to somehow save commit with this settings file but not with chat file because it's incomplete. So that's where you realize the importance of staging area. Instead of, now you only add settings.txt because this is the only file where you have done your work completely and this is still incomplete. So now you add only settings to the staging area, and again ignore this I showed you to some file thing, like text thing, not a git issue again, promising. So git commit minus m added settings feature. So let's clear. And if you see now git status, it tells you that yeah, there's a file called chat.txt which has not been marked, not been added in staging area. That means it has not been marked to save a snapshot of that file. And see, you see settings is not there because we have added that to staging area. We can again verify this by seeing the commits using the command git log. So if you see, the recent commit has been added settings feature, which is after the home page. So I think it's clear at least now, like how to add files, commit. Then let's make another feature, like suppose this time groups and let's complete chat. So this is what you'll be frequently using. Like let's make something called groups.txt. This is groups feature and let's complete chat also. Now mostly you see in general after making 4 to 5 files, it is mostly in most cases in 99% of the time you add all the files to the staging area. So let's do that this time to be familiar with the real scenario. So git add my, so one second before that, let's do git status. In fact, let's make changes in the old files also. Change design in design change in home page. Yeah, that's it enough, I think. Yeah, then let's do git change status. Yeah, you see, it tells, okay, an old file has been modified and there are two new files which need to be added. So this is the most common scenario while working on a code base. You generally modify an old existing files and then you add your own files to continue development. So then I add, since my work is completely done, I will add all the files, git add minus a. Now let's check git status. See, all the files are in green. It means all these files are marked in staging area. It means all these files are ready to be committed. So yeah, now I do git commit minus m finished important features like chat and groups. So let's again do that git log. So yeah, this is a series of commits. First you finish your important task, then you, before that you did settings feature, and before that you added login and homepage. So yeah, I hope this idea of adding committing is grilled with you, and this is what you'll be doing 99% of the, sorry.
Yeah, so I think you have covered one part of the topic, so let's just take a small 2 minute stop and just if there are any questions.
Exactly, that was the next plan actually, that was the next slide. So before that, just a meme to feel relaxed and yeah, don't take seriously. And yeah, after this, yeah, it's open for doubts.
So guys, do you have any doubts?
Yeah, I can, if you want to repeat any topic, if it's not clear or if any part thing is not specifically there, yeah, feel free to mention. Like, hello. Swarnava,
Aditya Swain. Do you have any problem till now? Somebody
no,
raised
it's fine. I got it clear.
No, if there is any topic which seems okay, like
hello?
Not clear. Pankaj.
Why do we need the staging area? I mean, why can't something like git directly add, directly commit some files?
I actually did that in demo also, like where I, okay, let me do that again. Now let's think of other feature called logout. And I add logout feature, echo logout done, and logout. And let's add another feature which is maybe profile. And suppose this part is not done, like you have completed a logout but profile is not done, so you are not sure to save. Suppose, okay, let's incomplete.
So I wanted to know, why cannot Git directly allow me to like Git commit logout or something like that? Why should I add logout then commit? Like, anyway, I'm going to do only with logout, so why not something like directly Git commit logout? What is the point of staging area, having a staging area in middle?
Now you
tell
me.
I want to commit only logout, I don't want to commit profile. That is the point you're trying to tell me.
Exactly.
So why cannot I directly just commit logout and not commit profile?
So how do you mention that you want to specifically commit these files, right? You need to mention, like, how do you mention that, okay, these are the files. Now here there are only two files. Suppose there were 10 files and you want to commit only 3 files. So then what do you do? Like, how do you tell Git?
Okay, thanks.
Pankaj, na? Okay, let's complete this.
There are some other doubts in the chat box.
Okay, let Git add logout because that is the only thing done, and added logout feature. Git log. Okay, then let's take other doubts. It is good to track the
repository. Get in it. Explain.
Get in it. Okay, so see, you have made a new folder. Suppose I come out of Facebook clone and I make a project called Instagram clone, and I move to that clone and I make some files called stories. And now suppose I do git status, so it tells me it is not a git repository, and it has not found any of the directories called .git. So basically git is not tracking this project. So what git init does is git init is a way of telling ki, hey git, track all the changes that are going to be done in this folder for me. So yeah, that is the main purpose of git init. You obviously do that only once, because obviously once you are told it continuously tracks, then all your job is to add the files, commit, add the files, commit, add the files, commit. So yeah, that's it. Then Priyanshu, what command was used to commit modifications in an existing file? I don't know why this, I'm sorry, maybe I didn't make it clear. So a commit is a commit.
Just a minute, you can actually unmute and ask.
I think I understood Gargi's doubt. Let's first clear that. So Gargi, it's nothing like something called commit for changes in new files, commit for changes in old files. Git doesn't care whether it's new files or old files. Whatever files are in staging area, it commits. Like commits matlab takes a snapshot of all the files that are in staging area. So there's nothing like old. It's an old file, new file. You don't care about it. Just add the files, whichever you are. Git add -a. If you don't specifically care which files you want to add, and git commit -m. So it doesn't matter whether it's a change made in old file or a new file or something like that. So hope it's clear, Gargidas. And Aditi Maurya, I think, raised hand till now before.
Yeah, I have a doubt. Like if I clone a repository in my local machine and made some changes, after that, if I commit those, then will it alter the file, or it just alter the local file which I have cloned? Because if I don't want to make a pull request in the main repository, so will that cloned repository will be only altered, or the main repository will also altered by that?
Aditi, glad you are way too ahead. Like, we have that content covered, cloning and how to send a PR properly. So that's at the end of the workshop. So if I discuss now, many will be confused. So we introduce things in flow. so that people don't get confused. So would you mind waiting till the end? So
yeah, sure, you can
Yeah, sorry for not clearing it, making it clear, but yeah, I'm afraid that it will confuse if I mention things like push, pull, pull request and all that jargon. So yeah, sorry. Other doubts?
Okay. Like you can clear it in the end of the session.
Thanks. That content will be covered in the workshop only. Any more doubts?
Someone asked about git status. You can tell that.
Git status is used to represent the status of the staging area, not only the staging area. Now suppose I do git init for it. Okay. I wrote some content in stories feature. Stories. Array, sorry, file name. So now I have a file with stories which has some content in it. I do git status. Now I haven't added this stories file in the staging area yet. So let's see what git status tells. So it tells ki this there has been a new file called stories, but it hasn't been added to staging area yet. So acha, in a way you can think that it tells about staging area only. That depends on you, how you want to what's your perspective on it, because staging area is in the middle. You can always have it in your frame of reference that okay, it tells whether files are in the staging area or not. But suppose you commit, then there's nothing, it's not talking about staging area, right? Git commit minus m stories added. Git status. Now there's nothing about staging area. It tells ki there's nothing to clean. From your frame of reference, you can talk it as there are no files to be in the staging area. But a better perspective would be that all the versions that you wanted to save have been saved. There are no more file changes that you have made and that are unsaved. So I think that would be a better frame of reference to look, rather than look in terms of staging area, the message of git status. So.
Shubham would like to take over for a while, so Kaushik, you can take a break, 5 minutes or something.
Okay. So there is another doubt from Suhas saying, when are we making a text file? By default, it is making a text file if we do not mention the extension. See, actually, there is nothing called a text file as such, right? So there's only file which is some location in the memory having some bits stored, right? Some designated bits stored. So if you use Linux, actually this concept would be more clear. So basically files can have multitude of extensions, but there are only two types of files. One is the regular file and another is the binary file. Okay, so if you have used file operations in some language like C or Python, you might be familiar that we have two modes of reading called R mode and the RB mode. So while using the RB mode, it actually gives takes in binary files. And if you use normal R mode, it treats everything as a text file. So if you do not even mention the extension, then it's generally a text file, but it does not necessarily mean that it will have a .txt at the end. Does that answer your question, Suhas? Okay, fine. Okay, so Aditi is asking, is it preferred to use Linux in a long run rather than WSL? Okay, so yeah, so that's a big question, a big debate. So I personally am a Linux enthusiast, that GNU Linux ecosystem enthusiast, and I advocate using Linux for everything else. So from my perspective, the answer would be yes, but at the same time, there might be some software that only you can run on Windows, like Visual Studio, for example. So if you are it depends upon your use cases, right? So my use cases actually get pretty well solved by Linux itself. So I use Windows. I use Linux every time, but there are some software which are Windows specific, so there you need to use Windows only. Okay, anything else? And yeah, Aditim, does that answer your question?
Basically, I was asking for the open source community, like they prefer generally Linux over WSL or others. So that's why I was asking about it.
That depends on the, that also depends on the project. So there are software even in on Windows platform that are open source. So like, it's not a problem actually. You can use anything you like. But if it becomes system dependent, then you have to check with the community what operating system they are using. So maybe there are some open source projects that do not support Linux at all. Okay. So there, for the development, you might have to switch to Windows. But generally, yeah. Generally, if you see most of the heavy stuff and most of the open source stuff, they can run on Linux pretty well. Like if you have heard of Docker, I think you might have heard. So Docker actually runs better on Linux, and the support for Windows is pretty bad.
Let's just stick to the queries related to Git and GitHub for now. If you have like any other open source related queries, we'll answer them later after the workshop ends.
Yeah, you can put them in queries channel also.
Okay, so there is another question from Anushka. If I used Git init, then I am putting all the files of that directory I am initially in tracking mode, or all the files in my desktop. Oh, so Git init actually doesn't start means by tracking. Are you meaning that you are putting them in staging area? I think so. So actually, what happens is that let me show you what happens while we do Git init. All right. So let me actually share my. So, yeah.
Hello, Shubham?
Yep.
I think it's extending, so we may not be able to cover other topics, so let's continue. And hello, Shubham? Let's clear Anushka's doubt in a single line if possible, or else we can, let's take it then. If I use Git init, then I am putting all files of the directory I am initially in tracking mode, or all the files in desktop. See, basically, suppose I'm in Instagram clone and I did Git init here, it tracks all the changes in this folder, like all the files and folders that are visible after I do ls of Instagram clone. So this is what Git tracks. After you do Git init, it tracks all the files and folders present in that current directory. So if you are in desktop and you do desktop in Git init, then it tracks the tracks all your files and folders in desktop. Yeah, so that was it. So yeah, let's get back to workshop. Oh shit. Okay. So this is kind of a small fun story to explain the importance of how you can undo changes using Git even after someone has messed up with your code or your code has been fucked up by someone. So basically this is how I plan to show. So let's first move to Facebook clone. So now suppose you have a cat that I showed here, and you are planning to build this Facebook clone, and its plan is to destroy your code base and maybe massacre your code base so that you don't build something at the end. So when you are not there, the cat checks the time, and basically suppose this is your code base, it massacres, it spoils by adding like this garbage content in files. Much garbage. Let's add this in other files also. When you come back, and see, when you check Git status, it shows too many files have been modified. So, and when you check the content, so you find garbage. Now, if you are not using Git, what would you do? You would have to do Control Z and check each time what was not done. So now these are few changes only, but what if there were too many changes and changes were made in too many files? So let me first remove this profile. Now basically, so this is the summary of the beginning. So there's a cat which tries to spoil your code base. So it goes to your files and adds random garbage in your content and your files, and now you are in this stage. So since you are smart and you are using version control system, what you can do is you can simply undo the changes using Git checkout dot. So and when you do this and do Git status, it shows the same stage. And if you check the files, they are in the same way like lastly how you did them. So the cat's plan has apparently failed. So now the second part, as I said, it's a trilogy. Now cat has figured out that you are using version control system. So this time it plans to make some changes and commits. So again, garbage content time. Already added that here. Let's add here. So now it does git add minus a, and you come in the right time and the cat runs off. But if you see git status, there are files that have been already added to staging area, and you want to go back to the stage where you have a clean commit history, like the stage where you had your last commit. For that, the command is git reset minus minus hard head. So if you do that and do git status and check, it shows a working tree clean, and you see again all your files are clean and safe. And now the third part, this time cat sneaks into a proper time, adds again random garbage, Let's make this. It adds garbage, and this time it commits also. Cat commit to destroy plants. And now it doesn't stop here. It makes in other files too. Or any other files. Okay. Are you? So then it does this, and then again another evil cat commit. And when you return back and check git status, yeah, it's clean. But when you do git log and see, there are two rubbish commits. One something that another evil cat commit and cat commit. But you had your project good and perfect at this stage. So now what you would like to achieve is your files should go back to stage where it was this commit. So git log should be basically this this thing, and you want to go back to a stage where this was your most recent commit. So for that, there's again handy command git reset --- hard. And suppose you want to, as I said, every commit has a hash, unique hash. Suppose you want to go back to this commit, then you copy its hash and you paste it. Suppose copy pasting is a pain, then you can simply type for 7 letters of the commit, like B1DC8C7. So now if you do, let me clear the screen and git log and see. Yeah, you are back at the stage where your last commit was git log feature. And if you check the files, yeah, all are perfect. Like login page, this is perfect. And chat, yeah, this is a single file, nothing has been changed. So this is just to demonstrate how powerful Git is. And these are really handy. Like it happens that it in certain changes, you after committing, you make some changes and you realize that you have done some rubbish thing. Then all you do is git checkout dot. And sometimes it happens that you add also those rubbish changes and now you want to go back to your that commit. So then you do git reset --- hard head. So I think the reset --- hard head seems okay. Like reset tells you to go back to that stage, and hard is something strict, I mean like indicating strict. It is worth mentioning about head here. Head something can be thought of as a reference to your last commit. So head is reference to your last commit. So after you add those rubbish files to your staging area, and you want to go back to your last commit, then what git reset --- hard does is it takes back to the files to that stage where your last commit was there. So that's why after adding rubbish files to the staging area and doing git reset --- hard head, you went back to your last commit. And suppose you have committed those rubbish files and rubbish changes, and you want to go back to a commit. So this might seem like and very unlikely, but this happens. If you continue working, you'll need this very often, because yeah, this is real often. So then you do git reset --- hard and first 7 letters of the hash, or simply commit, or simply copy that hash of the commit completely, and you get hash after you do this git log. So basically copy this whole thing or type the first 7 letters. So yeah, that was just to demonstrate a useful daily use case. Then I think, yeah, this is just the part one. Yeah, after a commit, then after they have been added to staging area, git reset --- hard. And after commit, even after rubbish commits are made, you can go back to your safe commit, git reset --> hard, commit hash. So yeah, this was it. And just another meme. So I'm not sure if you're getting this feel, but when you work and after you go back to your previous commit, you really get this feel like traveling back in time, wala feel. So yeah, just aiming. And now let's talk about another killer feature of Git called branching. So first let's try to find out a motivation for why do we need something called branching. So let's say there are two coders, programmers, Dinesh and Guilfoyle, who are working on a code base. They plan to work independently. And suppose you have a repo and both want to work independently. So what would they do? Each one would have a copy of their code base and they would work on it independently, something like this. So there's an original code base. Guilfoyle has his copy of code base and Dinesh has his copy of code base. Now the problem is after both are done and they want to put their changes in the original code base, the great pain would be they have to compare each file with the original and copy those changes. So if it's one or two files, it seems a simple task, but in general, if you are building a software, it contains a simple web app can have up to some 10 to 12 files. So comparing would be a great pain. And another thing which is trouble for manual merging of files is manually putting individual code base into your original code base is you have to ensure that they don't have proper and don't have conflicts. Like Dinesh wrote something and Guilfoyle wrote something. What if Guilfoyle, after putting them in original code base, something has happened such a way that Dinesh code has overwritten Guilfoyle's code. So this is just with two people. Imagine there are more people, then you would have more copies of code base and more issues. And obviously each one would be working at own pace. And it would be really difficult to manually keep track of who made what changes and how you want to update and when you want to update your code base with changes that are made in the original one. So basically the motivation is you have a code base and you want to experiment independently without spoiling the main code base. So for that there is called branching. So you can visualize a code base think of a code base as a series of commits. That's what it is, like series of versions. So and here the versions are like commits are visualized as these blue dots. So suppose this is you made a commit and you want to independently work out on a little feature like here, and it seems it has worked. And then you can just with a single command, you can merge the changes in your main copy just with a single command without having manually check anything. And you complete development flow. And here the beautiful part is someone on master can keep working on continuously, and someone else who's working independently on feature, he can work continuously. And even after a difference in commits with something like git, you can merge the changes very smoothly without much hassle. So this is the main reason for using branching. So just to revise, you have a series of commits and you want to experiment. And so experiment by mean you hop onto a virtual copy of the base, make changes there and obviously commit there. And now what would you want is you want those commits or obviously those changes to be in the original one. So you merge those changes. So once again, to drill the idea. So I think one thing that is worth mentioning is by default, when you start working, you are always on a branch called master by default. So if you see the commit message always told something like on the branch master. So when you start working by default, you are on a branch called master. So let's a different way of approaching. So again, the book example, you are on master branch and you wrote first chapter and you commit. You wrote second chapter and you commit, and you wrote third chapter and you commit. Now after third chapter, you feel like you want to experiment and this is not the end of the book and maybe you want to make changes in your previous files and you don't want to mess up the original. So you hop on to a branch, maybe called experimental branch, abbreviated as EXP, make a commit and make another commit of in the same experimental branch. Now you are happy with the changes and you would like to have those changes in the original one. So with a single command of git, you can merge these commits. By merging the commits, I also mean merging the changes in the files into the master branch. So then the overall picture would be something like this. So this would have ultimately master branch would look after you have merged the changes from your experimental branch. So if it's not clear, let's experiment. Let's do hands on. So again,
it
back.
The first three commits.
Doesn't change the first three commits. No, what you have done is you have made a series of commits and you have hopped onto a different branch and that branch has these commits. So please wait for a few minutes with demo. When I do Bitlog, it will be more clearer. So I think it will be cleared in few minutes. If not, yeah, we have a doubt session immediately after this. So do not worry. So what we plan to do is make a experiment on building a feature called poke feature. So what I want to do is I don't want to mess up with the original branch. So what I do, I first create a branch called poke. To create a branch, what I do, git branch name, which is, it is always a good idea to name your branch relevant to something you're working on. Since I'm working on something called poke, let's name it poke only. Now, if you see grid branch, there are two branches, one master, one poke. And you see master is highlighted with a small star also. That means you are currently on the master branch. Now, to experiment, you would like to go to the poke branch. So git to hop on to a different branch, the commands are git checkout poke. So switch to branch poke. Also to verify, we can use the command git branch and yes, you are in git poke. So if I do git log of poke and see, it contains the same commits because from that way I have diverted and I have not made any changes. So let's add a poke feature, poke.txt and this. Is poke feature. Okay, now git status. Okay, that is added. Git add minus a. This is easier. Like git add minus a, even if you make in one file, people are habituated to do minus a instead of explicitly mentioning. So yeah, make a habit to git add minus a, then git commit minus m, added poke feature. So if I do now git log, I have poke feature commit also, because now to exit this, you need to press Q and I'm on poke branch. Once again, let's make sure that we are on the same page. I'm on poke branch. I made a recent commit added poke feature. And now, if I hop on to master branch back and I do git log, there is no poke commit. And if I see the contents of the master too, I can't see any poke file. But if I go to you get it right, you are on a branch called master and changes on this master are independent of the changes made in poke branch. So if you want, we can check once again, git checkout, hopping on to poke branch, and I check the files. There is something called poke.txt with changes made, and git log, there is poke feature commit, and on master, let's check. There's nothing called poke and in git obviously there will also not be any commit related to that. So now what I would like is, suppose you are happy with the poke branch, happy with the changes in poke feature, and you want them to be merged in your master. Something like this scenario where you have three commits in master and here you have only one commit and ultimately you want to reach this scenario. So we would like to merge basically the changes in poke branch or commits in poke branch to change to your master branch. So let's for that the command is git merge and the branch name. So you want to merge branch or poke, so you do git merge poke. So yeah, let's now check the files. You see there's a file called poke.txt and there are contents, and if I see git log, yeah, there's also poke commit feature, poke feature commit. So yeah, this seems very simple because I made change only in one file and there's only one branch. In reality, you will have to work with sometimes 3 to 4 branches, like not you independently. There are 3 to 4 branches on a code base and you make changes not in obviously one file, like a new file. There are changes where you make completely 3 to 4 new files and you would want to merge them. So yeah, this was a demo of branching. So since this is an important one, we would like to clear your doubts first before moving on forward. So regarding branching and hopping on different stages, open to doubts.
Can you please show once again how you changed the branch? I'm getting some error.
Okay, so now I am in master branch. Do you want to create a new branch or what?
Yeah, like a new branch.
Okay, a new branch. So first let's create a new branch. Git branch, and this time suppose a feature called feed. So I want to add something called a feature called feed, and so I create a branch with name feed. So let's check whether that branch has been created or not. Yes, the branch has been created. And now I want to hop on to that branch. So the command is git checkout, I hop on to feed. And suppose I make feed, feed file, and feed feature. And let's do this git status. Let's add, let's commit, added feed feature. And now you are on feed branch and you made a commit related to feed feature. It is visible in git log when you are on feed branch. And you can also see the files. Where is the feed? It's here. And let's hop on to now master branch. And there's no feed file and you can check the commits too. The recent one is poke, not feed. Suppose you are happy with feed and you want to merge it, git merge poke. Yeah, let's do this. So let's see git log. I want to merge feed, sorry, git merge feed. So if I do git log, and yeah, recently feed feature commit is also there and I can also see the files. Is it clear or anything more?
When I try creating the new branch, it shows me an error and it says not a valid object name master.
Not a valid object. Oh, wait, you want to create a new branch. Why did something called master come? Like here I am on master. I want to create a new branch named experiment. So I write git branch and name of the experiment. Then why did something called master come? I think someone from course can think personally and let's check by screen
can
sharing.
Can you copy and paste the message that you're getting in the chat?
Yeah, yeah.
Mm, Ruchi Shukla asked, will there be any difference if we merge master with POC than POC with master? Let me make it one second. Master to merge with POC. Yeah, let's make that visually clear. So in master, you have three commits. Okay, let's see this. Okay. Now I'll create another branch called experiment and hop on to that branch. Touch and also add. Okay, I will make it clear. Experiment. Okay, this is now. If you see, the commit history of experiment, it has experiment added feature, poke and this, and you can see in commit history of experiment only it shows that master is here. So if we can go and check at master also, and do git log, and the last commit in master was feed feature, while last commit in this is experiment, it's experiment commit. So feed feature is already there in master. So in simple words, what is there in master is already there in experiment branch. So new things are required in master branch, not in experimental branch. Experiment branch is already forward. So what you would like to have is, you would like to have this change in your master branch too. So that's why you merge poke. That's why you merge experiment with master. That's why. So you want changes from experiment branch in your master branch. So that's why you do git merge experiment and get that commit here too. Now you see here also you have that experiment commit. Or maybe to make it clear, master has only three commits, while experiment has these three and also these two extra commits. So now master is someone who is lagging behind. So that's why you need to merge these changes in experiment to get to this stage where there are two more commits in master too, so that master is updated. So I think it's clear. If not, I think
yeah,
someone else.
Understood.
Thank. Okay, cool. Someone else can take up doubts now.
I think Mehul has a doubt. You can address that.
Okay. If I delete something in experiment branch and merge it with master, will the file be deleted as well? Yes. See, basic idea is it's about changes rather than addition or something. So we can try that. Okay. Now I am on master. Now I want to remove poke feature. Branch unpoke. Basically, I want to remove poke. And I hop on to the branch unpoke. Let me verify. Yes, I'm on unpoke. And has Mehul asked, let's remove the poke file. Wait, let's do ls and rm poke. Poke.txt, okay. Okay, now let's do ls. And you see there's no poke file here. Chat, experiment, feed groups, like this. So I think that will be clear with git status also. Yeah, it says you have deleted. And let's add all the changes. Git commit minus m, removed poke feature. Oh, now you want this in your master branch. So master is at this commit, which is experiment. And if you see the state of unpoke branch, let me clear, it's a commit ahead of master, which is this commit. And what this commit reflects is there are all the files except poke. So the basic idea is now you want this change to be merged in master. So let's move to master. And let's merge and poke. So if you see now files, chat, experiment, feed, groups, homepage, login, logout settings, there's no poke. So the basic takeaway is it's not about addition of content or addition of files. It's about commits. So as I said, commit is how your files look at that stage. So when I took the commit from unpoke branch to be merged in master branch, I changed the files, the way files look, basically you want the changes changes that were made in unpoke to be appeared in master. So even though they are deletions, making a new file, deleting a new file, editing a file, it doesn't matter. Once you are a commit ahead, like in the series of commits, you think in terms of changes. So I'm not sure if I explained that well, but I think it with demo at least it is clear. If you want, you can suggest some experiments and we can do that on terminal. So sir, the takeaways, think in terms of changes, not in terms of addition or edits or deletes. Acha, Mehul sir, thank you. Shubham has a big doubt. Let's say we have a .c file called test.c in master. I need an extra function I wrote in different branch. Can I merge in test.c or separate file? Okay. I think in my demo, I didn't show clear enough. Like I said, it's always in terms of changes, not in terms of file additions or file deletions. But I will undo it by making more demo. Suppose I want to change design of the home page. So I want to experiment. So I make a new branch called design change, maybe design change. And I hop on to that branch. Okay. Now I am in design change branch. Now as Mehul, someone asked, let's add some content. Like you said functions, right? So here let's let function in function for improvement in design. Just ignore the typos. New content, improve design. So I think this was Shubham's doubt that if I make changes in at the end of the file rather than adding a new file, will those be merged? So yes. So let's make it clear. So now let's do get status and let me add get commit minus m. Suppose I added function to, this is some rubbish. Okay, but still add a function to improve design change. Okay. And if I see git log, okay, this has commit. Now let me move to master branch and do git log and check. It doesn't have that. What happened? Okay. It doesn't have that commit. If you see that file too, which was homepage.txt, it's just two lines. I think I'm sure that this was the file where we made changes. We can check that by moving to, what was the branch name? Design changes. And let's check with the file. So you see there's a difference in, this was master branch and the cat content of home page was these two lines. And like someone asked, in a new branch, you have added a function at the end of the file only rather than creating a new file. So as I said, think in terms of changes, not in terms of addition or deletion. So let's merge this and you approve that point. Get checkout master to move to master branch. Get merge design change. And if I do git log, I have that commit. And let me see the contents of the file. Yes, the function which you wanted in the file is added. So yeah, it is expected that it would show up. So yeah, think in terms of changes, not in terms of addition or deletions. So it's at the end of the file, or you removed a file, removed a content, it doesn't matter. It's about commits. Once you are like the difference in commit history is something like one branch is a commit ahead, you can merge those changes. So yeah, that's the main thing. How to do branching in VS Code? See, branching is a Git feature. So I have shown what things in VS Code are just normal things like creating a file, writing content to a file. So VS Code is a text editor, and text editor doesn't, I think, like VS Code is more advanced. I think it supports, but I think that is not the way, like that is not a good way to do branching in VS Code. So yeah, use terminal always. Like there's something called Git GUI. Okay, you can do that using VS Code terminal. Also, you are mentioning the terminal of VS Code. That's again terminal, right, Aditi?
No, I think he is talking about the extension that you have in VS Code. I think that's what he means. Even I have never used. I don't think anyone uses it.
Yeah, so even though
it's pretty useful, actually, there's another useful extension, Git Lens, but I don't think that is in scope of this workshop. So
okay, Lens is okay.
Not relevant.
For branching, I prefer that you use command line only. Command line is far more powerful and you can check the changes easily. So even though there are alternatives, like some new software comes up only for branching, stick to command line, which is super powerful and cool. So yeah, please do that. So something like file editing and changing and creating new files or deleting, so you can use your favorite text editor, but for Git features, command line is the best option. Like
I think the Git extension in VS Code is a useful useful tool for visualizing the commits. Like you can actually see the series in which the commits have happened. So that was what I found useful. Otherwise, that terminal is the best.
Okay. Still, are there any doubts that are above and I have missed? Can you try running Git branch? Okay, this was issue. Any more doubts? Like, hello. Was it not clear or? Hello.
Hello.
How
you got the homepage.txt file in the branch you created, design change?
How you got MATLAB? I didn't exactly it was already there, right?
It is a new branch, right? You created that time, and there is the file that is in the master. How?
Really sorry. Once again, can you repeat?
No. I think I got his question.
Okay.
He is saying that if you change the branch, how did that file appear there? Because that file was in the master branch, right? So actually, that is not how branching works. You are just creating a copy of that same code base, and it is just a different version of that code base. It doesn't delete or empty the repository for a completely new repository, right? So the file that was there in master will also be there in the other branch. Just that the changes that you make on that branch will be accessible only on that branch. You can't access them on the master branch. So yeah, that is basically it. Does that clear your doubt?
Yes, thank you.
Just adding to what Path told. So this is why I use this example, multiple copies of a file. So I think branching literally almost So you can think of something like this, multiple copies of your code base. Instead of having different directories, with Git branch feature, you can hop onto different states of your code. I think if you want to think like this, this would be useful. Like something in original will also be in others. But after you make changes in this file, this is independent of changes made here. So it is after you merge changes of this in this, you get those changes what you wanted. So, or I think this is one way, or one more easier thing is think in terms of series of commits. Think in terms of series of commits. This is a branch where it has commits, and there's another branch which has, which is far from master, like two commits ahead, and you want your master to have those two commits. So you merge these two commits in those. That is, you merge those changes, and you get. So in real life, merging branches is a bit messy, and because they are not so apparent changes. So, but as you keep on doing, you will know what are the issues. So our main scope plan of the workshop was to introduce the feature of branching, how you can move between branches, how you can merge. But yeah, as you move on, you will explore more advanced features. We also put some resources in our repo, GitHub repo of the workshop. We'll show that at the end of the day, okay? Not worry about that. So, but for at least till now, the basic branching, like how to create a new branch, how to hop onto new branch, and how to merge a branch, are these clear? Or can I proceed for the next sections? Okay. Some response from audience. Hello.
Okay. Let's move on to the next.
Okay, since we discussed this, so there are too many branches. Small last thing, you want to delete a branch, git branch minus D, capital D, and name of the branch. Suppose feet, I deleted that branch, sorry, check the branches, that's not there. So yeah, just a small another feature if you want to delete a branch. And yeah, let's get back to content. So yeah, now we have done part of Git. So let's, this quotation has been placed to introduce GitHub. So alone we can do so little, together we can do so much. So the repository, the code base, which we did right now, is only on our machine and only I can access it now. So what if you want others to access it? What if you want other people to check it, submit their code, and you want to have their changes merged in your code base? What if someone would help you to track all the problems or bugs in your code and help you with changes or fixing bugs? So there's a need of an online platform so that you can collaborate. So GitHub is that online platform where online people collaborate for working on a single code basis. So a simple analogy, but too simple, would be, think of a Google Doc. There's a document which a bunch of people are trying to edit. You share the Google Doc link, and multiple people can have access to the same content, and multiple people can make changes to the document at the same time, and others can see that in real time. Now, code bases are not that simple. They have too many files, sometimes hundreds and hundreds of hundreds. That some code bases have really large code bases, but simple ones have at least 20 around. And it is not so easy to just put it at some place and share that Google Drive link or something like done with Google Doc. So there is this online platform called GitHub, where you can put your code base. It tracks also what commits are of the code base. You can shift to different branches. You can check the code of each branch's code. You can check commits of each branch. You can track issues, and you can submit code to a repository that's open. You can have an own copy of the code that's available and build your own upon that. You can put up your repo so that others can see. So all these cool features are available in GitHub, and that's what GitHub is for. So for basically collaborative software development in one line. So one thing which I want to make clear is GitHub seems some related. So GitHub is just an online platform, and there are other websites which does that too, like providing an online platform where you can have code base hosted by one person and multiple people work on that and have all those features like look at commit history, look at branches and look at the issues of it. So there are other websites like GitLab, Bitbucket, which do that, but GitHub is the most popular one. So that's why we are teaching that. So yeah, GitHub is really powerful and really popular. So let's make an account. So our first plan would be to put our code base online. As I said, we built something called Facebook clone, and I want that on GitHub, and I want that open online so that everybody can see it, and everybody can submit their code, or everybody can maybe help me finding out what bugs are there. So first I need to put it on online. So for that, there's, I think better we would do it by demo. So please follow with me here. First let's visit GitHub dot, oh, sorry, github.com, and yeah, I want to put my new project now, and there is this nice plus sign, and I want to create a new repository and a name called Facebook clone. So please, I request you also to keep doing along with me, and a description would be clone of social media FB, and public and private is something apparent, like public only anyone can see it, private only you can choose who wants to see it. Initially it is only visible to you, but later you can add people who want to see it. And ignore all this, we will know what all these are in a minute. So yeah, let's create a repository. So basically this is the link of your repository, and you want to have your files over here at this link. So so when I made the presentation, I called push and pull. So here's where push comes in. So when you want changes on your machine to be on GitHub, you push the changes, and you want changes from GitHub to your machine, you pull them from GitHub. So let's first clear the push part. So let's first push our code base to GitHub. So let me copy the link, and I am in Facebook clone directory, and I want to push it. So let me git push. I want to push to this link which I copied. Let me copy that again. Control C and paste, and git push, and the branch name, what branch you want to push. So apparently I'm on master branch, so let me push that. Generally people push the default branch first. You can push any other branch also, but master is most regularly pushed, the default one, which is. So git push and the URL and master. Okay, wait, it's asking for name. It should ask for name. Let's wait. This script bash seems a bit slow. Let me do that again. This is shit. Okay, I have stopped the process.
You can add a remote and then
relax. Parth, don't reveal the suspense. I'm coming to it. Relax. So yeah, git push link. Arre yaar, ye yahan pe pooch raha hai. Generally it asks on terminal only. So I want to show that from terminal actually. And yeah, it's not an issue. Even it asks on terminal. It asks from an app like this. I think git bash is programmed like that, but let me show from terminal so that अरे यार और वन सेकेंड सी डी एक सेकेंड एम एन टी वन सेकेंड आई एम जस्ट मूविंग टू द डायरेक्टरी रिलैक्स एंड वर्कशॉप एंड दिस इज फेसबुक क्लोन अरे सो आई एम ऑन फेसबुक क्लोन लेट्स git push sorry for this text like this the link I copied master this dot git should not git push
when you copy and paste in git bash it there's an extra at the then the extra character at the end I think that should be causing the problem
let's try at least here only this should work actually one second are ye four it kya hai ye git push https://github.com/rakhar/facebook-clone repository is fine master bitlet it open and log in. Let's do it from here only. Generally it asks terminal. If it asks from terminal then fine. Okay, sorry for that. So sorry for that. That was not expected actually. So yeah, so git push and link of the repository and your branch, so that should do. Generally since I'm using git bash, it opened some new GUI and asked me to enter there, but if you are on some Linux terminal or Mac, it will ask on terminal only, and there only you can type your credentials and just push it. So let's reload and check. Yeah, so you have all those files and this, and you can see the commits. Like say all those commits in order, hash of each commit, and yeah, this is it. And there are more, but let's make a small change. So there is something called readme.md for each GitHub repo, which helps you to add info about the repository. So let's just make for this one. I think made while workshop. Let's just add this basic content. Created. This is the default which GitHub suggested, and I will make my own. Created. Added. readme.md. md file. So yeah, directly commit to the master branch. So GitHub suggests something called making another branch in PR. So I want to directly commit to master branch. So now we are at a stage where master branch on GitHub has 10 commits, which is the most recent commit is this. And the code base on our machine last commit is this. Added function to improve design. So the code base on our machine has till this, while the code base on GitHub is a commit ahead. So now you want the changes on this GitHub repository to come on to your machine. So when you wanted the changes on the machine on GitHub, you push those changes. Now you want the updated changes on GitHub onto your machine, you do the opposite. So pull. So you just pull. So git pull. Let me type the link, that's easier. github.com/rakhar, which is generally username/facebook. Generally my username. So the format of repositories is something like this: github.com/username/name of the repo. So it's Facebook clone and the branch name. So if I see git log now, it has that commit. And for verification, let's check the file. Sorry. Yeah, the file is also there and the commit is also there. So remember this, when you want changes to push to GitHub, you push. Okay, sorry for that. You have your code base, you want changes on GitHub. So you want changes to be updated on GitHub, you push. You want changes, you have a code base which is not updated, but on GitHub, the code base is updated, like it was here. It was a commit ahead. It was a commit ahead. Then you pull. So to update GitHub, you push. To get updated, you pull. So I think that's clear. Now I want to introduce one more concept. Now you see there was always a pain of copying link and pasting it or typing the whole link. So it would really be nice if we store these links in a single variable and use that variable every time, like you're doing programming too. So such variables which store these links to the repository are called remote, R-E-M-O-T-E. So if you to list all the remotes, you can do git remote -p. So since there's no remote, it is showing nothing. So since we push or pull to this repository, since we push or pull to this repository, github.com, it would be nice if you store this link in a variable and every time use that variable for reference while you want to push and pull. So for that, the command is git remote add name of the remote. Now you can put anything, but the general convention is to put origin for your repo. Basically, since this is my repo and my machine, it is suggested that you put origin. You will soon know why. Git remote add origin and the link. https://github.com/facebook/clone. So let's add origin. And if I do now git remote -v, so if I do git remote -v, it lists all the remote variables. So I have recently added origin here. So origin refers to this. So it tells that you can fetch and push. Fetch is one substage of pull, which we are not covering in this workshop, sorry. But pull does this does more than what fetch does. So that is why we introduce you to fetch rather than that is why we introduce you to pull rather than fetch. So basically this means you can push to this link and pull from this link. So now let's test that. Suppose you make another feature, like I improve readme.md, more content in readme.md, readme. Remember to append, you use double arrow, but never mind, you can do that using VS Code also. Readme. And now let's commit, added more content. Content in readme.md. Now if you do git log, you have the most recent commit as this. If you see on GitHub, the recent commit is something else. It is backward. So you push the changes to GitHub. Git push. Since you have saved the link in a variable called origin, you can use origin. And the branch name obviously as last time. Done.
After git log, what you type to get on the cursor again after the
Q, dollar sign? Q. Hello. Q.
Okay. After git log, what you type?
Q. Just press Q.
Q. Oh.
Yeah. So see, yeah. After pushing, the commit has been updated. And 1 second. Okay. Readme.md has more content. See, more content in readme.md. So yeah. Now let's test that with pull so that this idea gets grilled in your mind. Let's make here some more changes. More. Okay then let's what do I put? Okay, I think this is better. Let's update readme.md. Now you have your code base on GitHub repository is ahead of the code base on your machine. So I meant if you check its commits, the last commit here is update readme.md, and before that it's update more content in readme.md. And if I do git log here, the last commit is this only. So this commit is absent. So I want to pull this change from GitHub. So since I want to pull, I do git pull. Remember, we saved the link in a variable named origin, remote variable, if you want to be specific, and git pull origin and the branch of this master. Yeah, let's check git log now. It's the last commit is update readme.md, which was here, and just for satisfaction, content also has been updated. So, 1 second. That's what I meant by rock and roll, push and pull. So there's something worth mentioning about this cat. So Octocat is the logo of GitHub, and GitHub, don't know why, there are many people, it has developed different versions of this Octocat, like one Rockstar, you can get one on like Daft Punk wala also, like they have many Octocats, if you say. So this is one such cute logo, which is nice, and so I put it here. And yeah, this was about remotes, like variable name which can store your repo link, which is direct generally in this format, github.com/username/repo name. So now any doubts in push pull remotes? And yeah,
can you again show how to create new remote?
Remote, okay. Wait, suppose I'm doing something very useless. Suppose I have another repository named, suppose there's another repository with this link, https://github.com/rakar, which is, as I said, username/repo name. So suppose there is another, suppose there is another person named Graphio12, who has also this copy of Facebook clone, and I also want to push and pull directly from there. So every time, because I don't want to copy the link, I save them in a remote variable, and such variables are called remotes, and you can save them with any name. So the, like you asked the syntax, I think git remote add name of the remote. Origin was the convention which you regularly push and pull to your own repo. Now since this is some other person's repo, I can keep it something like Graphio, maybe Graphio, and type the link. Generally you can paste also, but okay, let's paste now. If I check git remote -v, it shows that you can use this variable whenever you want to push and pull to this repository. So if I want to do git push Shubham's repo, Graphio12's repo, I do GitHub, instead of doing this, I can simply use Graphio and the branch name. So, this is how you create and check what remotes you have and that how you push and pull. So anything else more? Git remote add remote name or remote link? Yeah, Mukul Mehta exactly summarize the syntax.
Why we should write the master after that?
Basically you can push other branches also. So the master was specific. Master I put specifically to specify that I want to push master. So thanks for asking. Let's try pushing another branch. Like I am on master. Like what are the branches? So let's push experiment branch to my repo only. Git push origin. If you remember the original repo name, origin, and the branch exp. So if you see on GitHub repo, let me reload, and there is another branch called exp. Now you can see files in this and commits of this, and so that was the main idea of the branch name at the end of push and pull. You can literally push other branches also apart from master, and this was it. And there's also another feature which will help you to push from one branch to other branch. Like suppose I am from git, I want to push from experiment branch, I want to push from master branch to experiment branch. So there's a command for that too, git push origin, I think from current branch to exp. But this is generally not recommended. But the why I told you this is, the last part is reserved for branch name. Since you are on master, and if you mention your master, it will push to master. And if you are on exp branch and you pushed exp, git push origin exp, it would push exp branch code to GitHub like it did here. So that was the last part what it was reserved for. And Shubham, anything more?
Raghavendra, can you just talk a little bit about Anushka Singh's doubt? I tried to answer, but can
When I pull the repository using git-bash terminal, where these files are getting saved in my computer? One second, let's make this clear. So the directory is Facebook clone, and here are the files. You make changes in these files or make new files along with this in this directory and make them, and maybe edit existing ones or delete whatever. So what git push does is like how these, it pushes these files and how these files look to GitHub. So basically the changes made basically how your files look at currently on your machine look exactly the same as here. So when you pull, when you actually pull, what you do is how your files look on GitHub, you make them look the same way as them as on your machine. So now I'm master branch, right? Okay, nice. And here I make changes in suppose this file. GitHub allows this cool feature to edit files also. Make settings extra content again. This is again by default which GitHub suggested. And let's take this. Now, cancel. Let's go. I'll continue. I have committed, right? One second. Sorry for that. So I have updated settings.txt. So now, how do your files, what is the difference between code base here, master branch here, and here? So as I said, it is always good to visualize code base as a series of commits. So the difference is changes of this commit, changes made by this commit. So this commit made a few changes in, we know that it's settings file. Let's say it's also made in new separate other files. And you want those changes also to be in these files. Like now your settings file looks like this settings feature. But if you see on GitHub, they look something like this. Now this is only with, because you made with one file settings.txt. Now suppose you made in some 100 other files and you want all those changes in your file machine too. So for that you do git pull the repository and the branch. So what it does is make sure that the repository, how your repository looks on GitHub, makes the same way as the same way your code on your machine looks. So sorry, so the code base on your machine and code on GitHub make are equal, are same basically. Maybe parts, can you like elaborate a bit, like clear it problem? Push and pull, but
okay. So so suppose there are some changes in a remote repository, right? It like, and you want those changes in your local machine. So your local machine doesn't have those changes right now. Someone else made those changes, suppose. So maybe I actually let us do a demo, right? Raghvendra, I'll fork your repo and like make some changes and we can do it that way. Is that fine? Okay, Raghvendra is not here.
Second. So fork to abhi nahi introduce karte hain, like
I'll make some changes in your repository and then like they will get the context of like what is it actually useful for, push and pull. You don't need to like understand fork and all.
Now if you want to, you can't directly change in my code base, right? Uske liye again you have to send a PR and all. This would confuse. So no, I'm only making changes, right? This is like, Anushka, is it clear? Like I made changes on GitHub repository and I committed, and now my master, my code on my machine is a commit behind than the code on the GitHub. So I want changes from GitHub to come to my machine. So I pull the changes by typing git pull origin branch name, which is master. Now suppose I make changes on my machine, but those are obviously not on GitHub yet, and you want your GitHub repository to have the changes. So basically the code on your machine is a commit ahead of the code on GitHub. So now for updating your this repo, that is to have the extra commit on master to be on this GitHub repository also, you do git push origin branch name. So yeah, this is what you do. Anushka, so yeah, any part which is not clear, like but these files don't get saved in my PC.
I think she is understanding it like they are being downloaded. So the files are not being downloaded, okay, when you do git pull. It is just like git is checking if there are any commits where the files have been changed in some way. So suppose there is a commit on GitHub that has changed one line in a particular file, okay? So I want that change in my machine. So for that there is git pull. It is not like you are downloading the file. It is just saying that okay, I see that this line has been changed, I will change this line locally. So git does that. That information about the change is stored in the commit, right? And when it pulls, it sees that change and makes that change locally. So that is basically how it works. It just looks at the change and not the entire file. But if I have to download the files using Git bash, so you can clone the repo, right? You clone the repo in Raghavendra. Can you just like explain clone? He's asking about
that. Is actually at the next stage. So before that, I think down the pull part is not clear. So I think let's make changes on. So suppose this is my repository and I make changes here only.
No, I think the pull part
is not.
Let me give an example, a real life example like that you asked. That suppose 10 of you are working on a project, okay, suppose in an internship, and you are working in a very big project. So how will you work? See, one people means everyone will contribute to the same code base, right? So suppose in morning I made some changes, then after I, so just carefully look at it, means there will be one repo in GitHub, and suppose if we are 10 people, then there will be 10 copy in our local machines, right? So the important part is that whenever I make some changes, that should reflect to others people. Otherwise, there will be a miscommunication, right? So whenever I make some changes, suppose I work in morning and I push the code to the GitHub repo, so that other people will also see that, okay, I made some repo, made some changes. So they will pull the code then to get my changes in their laptop. Okay. And then someone else will make some changes, and then he will push to the GitHub repo. Then I can see that, okay, this is changed. Then I will pull that code. So think like a real life code, right? It's a real life
right.
project.
So that's why I wanted to like actually make some commits in like Raka's repo by pull request and stuff. Just to
that
see
comes that. Ahead, but it might confuse. So if we discuss
it
now,
might take some time, but I think that scenario is clearing your doubts that why Git pull and Git push is required, because what Raka you are doing, I think that is not reflecting a real life scenario, but I think that story will encourage you to understand.
So because I am the only one who is doing
yes,
that.
Because,
exactly.
Yes, because yes.
I think one more part what Anushka like is thinking is to change content. You are thinking maybe the download is the only way to have content on your machine from internet. So I think change that perspective, that if I want changes in my files, all I have to do is download content only. So what, when you do Git pull, what it does is, let's, I think Mukul told a very good example by Git diff. So now let's show it properly. So suppose this is a chat.txt. I made a change and if I see commits, the recent commit is update chat.txt, and if I see recent commit here, it's update settings.txt. Now obviously the code on GitHub is ahead of the code on machine, and the difference, and GitHub provides this good feature called seeing differences from what has been made, and this like it shows very nicely that this line, extra line has been added called change one. Now your aim would be to get these changes on your machine. So your doesn't have this change one line. You want this change to come appear on your machine. So you don't have to download the whole files, right? Like, do you need to download this whole chat.txt and replace? You want just this text, extra lines to appear at the end of chat.txt. So for that, the command is git pull origin. For that, you pull changes. So what this git pull origin master, for what this git pull origin master does is, it compares the differences. So the difference is only this, in this file, this line has been added. So when you do this, it compares changes, finds out that, okay, this is the extra line which needs to be added, and updates the file when you do that. So if you see, it's these all are basically telling ki compression of files has been done, and it shows ki it was this file where differences have been made, and this is the number of additions and changes. So 3 plus and 3 1 minus. So basically addition and removal of new lines, that is don't can't get confused. So basically it is these changes that are made on your file. So I think at least this is clear. So don't always think that for changes to appear on your machine from the internet, download is the only way, and you always have to click something like download button, then the change will, then something called a file will download and you need to replace. No, directly changes are written on the file directly. It compares the differences, and those differences are written directly to the file. So I think Gitpull is clear now. If not, still we can make more examples. Okay, thanks. Cool.
Just to maybe add another line.
Uh-huh.
The reason you're doing these differences is that if you have a code base that has say 10,000 files, you wouldn't want to pull all of them again and again. You would just store the differences in one file. The plus means an addition, that line was added. Minus means that line was deleted. So the reason you would do it is that you don't want to re-download the same thing over and over again. So there's a fixed format that you only download these difference files and apply these differences, that where there's a plus sign, you just add that line to the code, and where there's a minus sign, you delete that line from the code on your laptop. So you would only apply these differences and not download everything over and again. This perception of download a whole file over and again does not apply to code as such, because code is just text where you can add and delete lines of text.
Exactly. Actually, Mukul summarized it very well, that it just need to apply the differences as it's only text. You don't have to download the whole file or something. Just apply the differences. Yeah, thanks a lot for summarizing that link well. Can we proceed to the next section? Okay, so now the plan is to actually show how a real life contribution is done. So basically, you have, suppose there are different repositories like this on GitHub, like one here, and you want to contribute one. Suppose I go to, 1 second. Suppose I found this repo, and of course IIT-KGP user or, and I want to contribute to this repo. So generally file, this is how a code base looks like, it might be clear. And suppose you want to contribute, there's something called issues section where the bugs and these are listed. So, and if you open each, there's a proper description to that, what is the bug and what has been, or what is the, describes the bug. So if someone wants to contribute to this project, his or her aim would be to fix this bug, or if it's a feature, add that feature. So that is generally what contributing in open source replies implies, that there's a repo which is whose code is open, and you want to contribute by fixing bugs or adding features to that repository. So yeah, you look at this repo and you decide that, okay, it's a simple, and here's a description, and you see there's a simple description that, okay, the bug is in function add to numbers, which doesn't perform as it expected. When you add to numbers, it says it prints 3 instead of 7. Okay, there's a description, and it seems that you can fix it. So yeah, so if you want to fix it, the first thing what you might think come to your mind is download this repo, make changes, commit, and push directly to GitHub. So there are a lot of intermediate steps. Let's break this one by one. First, this repo belongs to this repo belongs to COS IIT KGP. So, and it is, and in different cases it belongs to individuals, like suppose Graphutil or Mukul M-Meth or some user, and it is generally not a good idea to directly mess up with this code base directly. So what we would personally like to do is have a own copy of your code base and work on that thing. So what I'll mean, I will show you. So to have your personal copy, GitHub provides a feature called fork. This helps you to have your personal copy of this repo, Git and GitHub Workshop 20. So yeah, I think this will be clear. So I think currently the repo, is quasi-idkgp/github as Git and GitHub Workshop 2020. So like I said, username/repo name. So when I fork, this asks if there are multiple organizations. I want in my personal account. Let's wait. So if you see, it has created a copy of this code base, and the repository is now is username, obviously my username, and yeah, the repo name. So now this is my personal copy. I can do whatever I want with it. Like I can directly make changes and whatever, delete files and whatever I want to do. So now it is here where I can experiment. So directly messing up with quasi-idkgp or someone else's repo is not a good idea. When you decide that you want to work on someone's repository, open source repository, the first step is you fork. That is, you make a personal copy of this repo. Once you have forked, now this
Like, can you ask people to fork the repo right now in their personal accounts? Like, it will make it more.
Sorry, thanks for telling. So currently, we request you to follow this along. Like as I said, sorry, I forgot to mention. So yeah, just go to this array. Let me put the link in chat.
So you can all fork the repo to your own accounts, and like you can make pull requests as Raghavendra will tell you, just to make it a bit more interactive.
So yeah, please follow on along with us. Let's wait for 5 seconds to fork. Everyone has opened and pressed on this fork button, and everyone has a copy of this repo, which would be something like GitHub, their username. In my case, it's Rakar is my GitHub username, and Git and GitHub Workshop 20, which is the repo name. So now this repository is on GitHub. Now I would like to personally work only when it's on my machine, so that I can make changes, run it and all. So the next step would be to have this repo on your machine. So for that, there's a feature called clone. So first you copy this link, which is also available here, never mind anywhere. And to clone means nothing but have the get the repository on GitHub to your machine. So you can also download, but clone is more Git way to get the machine on your repo rather than downloading. Let's come back to a directory, and yeah, to clone, as I said, git clone repo link. I copied it, right? Yeah, git clone the repo. So if you see the contents, the repo has been downloaded. Now let's move to the repository. Like I said, type half and press tab, you get the complete name. Let's now move to the repository. Now you might be tempted to open code, add commit, fix bug, add commit. But again, like I said, there is one more small rule. Why did we teach you branching? The main aim of branching was you can experiment without messing up with the original copy. Generally the default branch is master or main. So okay, so there's a small diversion here. Till October 1st it was master everywhere, but since this repository Git and GitHub was made after October 1st, this is currently main. So for us, in this repository, the default branch is not master, it's main, because we are doing this after October 1st, our bad luck. So yeah, this is so main is the default branch. So the what I meant to conclude is, it is not always a good idea to work directly on the default branch. If you want to experiment something, you should always make a new branch, experiment, send a pull request from that, which will tell what a pull request means is, hey, I made these changes, can you merge them in your code base? So that this fixes the bug or adds the issue. So that was the main idea of, that is the main idea of sending a pull request. That means, hey, these are the changes, and merge them so that the bug get fixed. And now, like I said, working on a default branch is not a good idea, because the default branch should be used to keep in sync with the original repo. This is the original repo. This is the original repo. Now, obviously multiple people will be working on this code base repo, and there will be changes continue coming frequently to this, like more commits will be coming frequently. So one branch, which is preferably the default branch, which is main here, is kept so that it is in sync with this repository. So the other branches other than the default, like other than main, are the ones which you will be working on. Like you will always be working on branches other than the default one. The main branch is used to keep in sync with the original repo, because frequently people will be pushing to it, and your other branch is where you will work and some and experiment. So I think it's clear, but yeah, let's do that. Let's make a new branch called bug fix, and let's hop on to that branch bug fix. Let's check. Git checkout bug fix. I think this repo is causing, this should not happen, but I think there is some this causing issue. What happened? Git invalid preliminary default argument. One thing, I think that's because I added this file and this is fucking up. Let me first delete that. CD repo. CD. क्या था? Git and GitHub. I will add the slides again. Sorry for this, but. This was not expected. I didn't know that something like this would happen. So generally you can safely check out. Let's update this actually. Git pull origin main. So that has been, see, that was two large file, and I think that was causing some issue. Generally that wouldn't happen. These such files won't be added. So I think something happened in the morning. Someone added some useless file. Sorry for that. In general, it doesn't happen. Like I said, main branch is only used to keep in sync. And main branch is only used to keep in sync with the original repo. And other branches are where you experiment. And we have created a bug fix branch. Let's move on to that bug fix branch. This is causing issue. I'm removing it. Okay, let me clone again. Sorry for that, but generally, I don't know why that happened. Okay, let's move on. And the branch is main. I will create a branch called bug fix as I intended to do. And I will move out to that branch. Okay, excellent. Now I am on bug fix branch. Now let's fix the code. Like you can open in any editor, not an issue. So the editor, like it was mentioned in issue. This is just for some purpose of real feeling of contribution. Like add two numbers instead of adding, it prints 3 instead of 7. So apparently there is a bug in function called add two numbers, which is not producing results as we expected. So instead of 5-2, it was expected 7, but it is printing 3. So if you see the function definition, in sum it's placed minus, so it should be plus. So now I think this will obviously print 7. So generally developers test after changes have been made. It is always not a good idea to directly push, but since this is something very clear and simple, I am not going to test this and run files. So yeah, the small issue is only was this sign. I have made changes. And let's add, like I said, mentioning path and file is a headache. Do git add minus a, git commit minus m, fixed bug in Python code. And now I will obviously push it to my a copy, which is, where is it? One second. Now this is where I downloaded the code from, and one second, and I will obviously push to this repository. Wait a second, where did I download from? I cloned from in hurry, I cloned from COS. So suppose I want to push and pull to my copy, then what I do? We have learned this, git remote add my name. Git push or remote name and branch. So yeah, this, if you see, if you refresh, without refreshing it appeared. Generally if something new has been pushed to GitHub, it shows this icon that you can send a pull request. So all you need to do is click on this button. So generally, as I said, pull request means, hey, these are the changes which fix the bug, and please merge them in your main branch so that you have a bug-free code. So here it shows from where you are sending to where. You are sending from bug fix branch of this repository to main branch of COS iitkgp/repository. So generally you write some main heading, which generally comes by default as commit message, but you can add more to it by correcting function definition, here you write description generally so that people understand. Here it's in markdown syntax, which you can learn later. So let's write replace the math sign to fix bug. So create pull request. As I said, pull request means hey, these are the file changes I made, please add them in your code so that you have a bug free code. So now someone from COS, please merge this now, like, so that to show that code has been updated. Hello.
Wait, I'm doing.
Yeah, I merged it. One.
Would you show the files change in PR? Yeah, I think I showed that. I only changed this file where this has been removed and this has been added. Basically, replacing of minus signs means I've removed the line sum A minus B and added line sum A plus B. And Script Ninja, it shows that some user by name Script Ninja has merged these changes. Now, if we see the original code base, it contains our code that we fixed, like, or in fact, we can see in the commit history itself that the last commit was mine, which I did by fixing Python code, and this was the Script Ninjas, which is merging of branch. This is included as another commit in GitHub, but yeah, you can see the changes. Like, if we can also see in files if you wish.
Someone has an issue with the error that you are getting, Rishabh Kumar.
Okay, one second.
Can you just tell him what to do?
Okay, just delete it and reclone it. So one second. Since this is a bit messed up, I will rerun it since we have. Okay, we are not short of time. This is the last topic. Let me just rerun it. Sorry for that. I never knew that small slide thing will cause such an issue. Let me delete this. You can go to settings and you can end of settings, delete this repository. Now let's just copy paste. So let's start fresh so that things are clear. If you want, it is suggested that you also remove your this fold by deleting as I did. Let's delete from this also. RM minus RF. Now the repo is not on my machine, not on my GitHub. So I plan, as I said, let's run through it faster. The code, this is cause ID KGP's code base. Since it is not a good idea to mess with their repo directly, you want to have personal copy. To have a personal copy, you have to do something called fork. And by forking, you have a personal copy of the repo on your account. So yeah, you can see this is now my personal copy of the repo git/github/git/github/workshop 2020. Now this is on GitHub, but not on my machine. If I want it on my machine, the Git way to do it is to clone. So I do git clone and paste the link. And the repo is now downloaded or cloned, I should say. And I can move to the repository. And let's now, before fixing a bug, as I said, the default branch, which is main branch should be used only to keep in sync with this original code base. Like whatever changes are made in this repo, cause IIT KGP/git/github/workshop 20, they should be made, that should be in sync with this main branch. Whatever you want to mess up, experiment, try something, those are recommended to be on a separate branch if you want to contribute. So as I said, the way to contribute is to send a pull request. Pull request is nothing but a fancy name for telling, hey, these are my code changes which can fix the bug or add a feature in your code. So please merge these changes. So like I said, to fix something, or to fix a bug or add a feature or solve a issue, you hop onto a new branch. So before that, let's select some new issue, like they said code is in sample.js and it says it performs the same thing. Let's create the new branch, this time a new thing, new name, like JS code bug fix. like because it's in sample.js. So now the branch has been created. And let me hop on to that branch by git checkout bug fix. Now let me check if I have hopped on or not. Yes, I am in that branch. Let's see in the code base. Or basically we can do, in your favorite editor, let's do it. So yes, again, it's the same thing, just a different language. Git status, if you do, there's a file that has been modified. Now, specifically mentioning is a pain. That's why I said git add minus a, do this all the time, like preferably. Git commit minus m, fixed bug in sample.js function code. So a commit message which would tell what you have done, and git push. Now we had last time used something called remote names, if you remember, to replace links, and you can get the list of remotes by doing git remote minus v. Now last time
I think your screen has muted. It is not going ahead.
Screen has muted.
I mean the screen has stopped. No,
it's working.
Okay, fine.
I think it's
It is a bit slow. Can you go a bit slow because the screen is like lagging?
Oh, sorry. Okay, where was I? So as I said, if you want to push directly, we do git push. Because we are lazy to type the link, we use a variable name. And last time we defined a variable name by using the command git remote add origin, add a conventional name which was origin, and specified the link. So, but this time if we see, there is already something called origin from where I have cloned. So this is the repo from where I cloned. My repo, I cloned by copying this link. So by default, when you clone a remote variable by name origin, is already been set up. So that is the reason why when we asked you to set a origin for push and pull, for easy push and pull, we named that as origin rather than any other name. So now you hope and understand why we named it as origin and not as any other name. So yeah, because it's already fixed, let's do that. Let's push it. Git push the link, because I don't want to type the link. There's an already variable name called origin which acts as a substitute for the link. Git push origin, the branch name, which is JS code bug fix.
Actually, everyone can make pull requests on the repository. There is no restriction. You can just make pull requests. We won't merge everything, but like you can just do it for trial.
Yeah, that is recommended. So yeah, if I open my GitHub, so hope this is visible. This icon already pops up directly that there has been recent change in this branch. Even if not, you can see the branch here, and this will still appear like no matter where you are. So you can make a pull request. Made changes in JS code. So my pull request this time made a changes in sample.js file. So by making this pull request, I am asking the owner of this repo, CauseIDKGP, to merge these changes so that the bug in this code is fixed. In general, there is another good practice which is worth mentioning here, that people also mention what issue they plan to fix. Like if you write hash, you get this drop down where you can mention a PR or an issue. So let's search for one of JS. Yeah, here it is, like fixed bug in JS code. So by mentioning this directly, it becomes clear to the issue owner that he is trying to solve this issue, trying to fix this bug or trying to add this feature. And one more cool thing is after this PR is merged, the issue gets automatically closed. So it would be nice if someone from COS merges this again. Merge kiya yo. Hello.
Ha kiya merge.
हेलो हाँ सॉरी मर्ज कर दिया ओके एक सेकंड लेट्स मी लोड सो या सो यू कैन सी द रीसेंट कमिट हैज बीन जेस दिस वन मर्जिंग पुल रिक्वेस्ट ऑफ द स्क्रिप्ट निंजा एंड द कोड विच आई फिक्स्ड नाउ एज आई सेड नाउ द मेन ब्रांच ऑफ रिपोजिटरी गिट एंड गिटहब वर्कशॉप हैज 16 commits and this is the extra commit if you see like the main branch of Git and GitHub workshop has these commits and if you come to your machine let's go to main branch and let's do git log and see the last commit is merge pull request number 14 which is this so the main branch on my machine has commits from here and I lack in my machine these two commits are not there so what do you have changes on GitHub you want them on your machine you do git pull so but this time you are not pulling from origin you are pulling from this repository so let's do that so sorry q to close git pull and the link github.com/cosiitkgp/20 now because this will and later the branch name now because this will be done frequently like I have to pull very frequently like I said it is always a good idea to store in a variable and we have discussed that variables such that store such reference to links are called remotes now we have remote for where we can our repo for our remote which is my copy which is one second so I have basically remote for I have remote for this repo so and its name is origin I want reference to this repo because I want to pull frequently from it and now is the time because I want it is two commits ahead and I want to pull those changes so what I do I again obviously set a variable name like here is another convention the original copy which is cosiit/kgp is generally named as upstream so origin for your copy upstream for the original one so let's add so your origin for where you can push generally and upstream is from where you direct generally pull so git remote add name of the variable which stores reference to your link so origin as I said for your copy where you can push and upstream from where you can pull git remote add upstream and let's type the link cosiitkgp/ okay. Now git remote minus v so you see now this upstream has also been added where I can fetch and push so let's now as I said this repository is two commits ahead I want to pull those changes from GitHub onto my machine so git pull the link which is substituted by the remote variable name upstream and the branch which is main so if you see now the commit history of my main branch it is in sync with the one present here. So the last commit is merge pull request 15, number 15. And here also the last pull request, sorry, commit is merge pull request from number 15. So I know we did a lot of things and that issue has more confused. Sorry, really sorry for that.
Actually, attendees, please make a PR to the course IIT KGP repo. Like that is one of the main takeaways from the workshop.
From this workshop. There's a small summary of what we did. Just to summarize, everyone please look at here. So summarizing till now what we did on how to send a PR. So there's a repo of course IIT KGP which has a bug in it. And there's a developer, Eric. Let's say his name is Eric and he knows how to fix it. So the first step in contributing, if he wants to contribute, is to have his own personal copy. So that thing is achieved by fork feature of GitHub. So the first thing that Eric does is he forks the course IIT KGP / codebase repo. So he first forks, now this is the symbol of fork, so that he has his own copy. Now you can notice that the repo format, like it's in course IIT KGP / codebase, that his personal copy would be in something like Eric / codebase. Now the codebase is on GitHub, but not on his personal machine. So to get that code on his, get the code of his personal copy on machine, he clones. So the next step is git clone this repo link so that the code comes on his Eric's machine. So the next thing Eric does is create a branch, work hard to fix the bug, then add, then commit. So after it's been done, then he pushes the bug free code to his code base. So the next thing what Eric does is sends a pull request. That means, hey, these are the changes which should be included in your repo so that it's free of this particular bug. So after pushing to his personal copy, he sends a PR. And once the PR is merged, the code base is bug free thanks to Eric. So once again summarizing, repo, bug repo, you are a contributor, someone like Eric. To contribute, first you make your own copy by forking, then you have that repo, have that copy on your machine rather than just having on GitHub by git clone, and then you make a branch, add, commit. Then after once committing, once you fix the bug and you are committed, the next thing you do is push to your repo. Then once you push and once you visit the GitHub page of this repo, of this repo, Eric / codebase, GitHub will show an option called create a PR. And once you click on that button, you have generated a PR to fix the bug. Generated a PR to fix the bug is simplified to something called take this code changes and merge them in your code base so that the bug is no more. And yeah, after that the PR is merged and the code is free of bugs. So yeah, next we want you to send a PR. This is the last thing which we want you to do. So yeah, I think the time is up, but still the last thing which we want you to do is send a PR and leave. So yeah, please do that and we'll be open to doubts from now. And before that, some parting tips. Hello,
just a minute, like we have a feedback form for you to fill before you leave.
Also maybe after you send the PR we could like have some discussion on good practices, maybe just like 5 minutes maybe of certain things. Like I think that would be a good idea.
Yeah, we can discuss that. And before that, I have some small things. You have learned to implement something what you have learned in this workshop. So the best thing would be to contribute to some repos out there And Meta KGP, since all are from, most of them are from KGP, you can check out this Meta KGP repository. Meta KGP is GitHub organization, where they have some really good issues, and try them. You can, by fixing them, you really contribute to the applications that people use. So do check out Meta KGP's repos. And if you are a beginner, something, a good idea would be to find out issues with this label called good put first issue. So if you see, the issues have different labels here to give an idea of who can try out and what this is about. So these bugs are about these issues are about some bugs, and these three features are about adding enhance by improving the code base enhancement, other word. And these are all good first issues, which means someone who is new to this environment of development can try this out. So if you are new, and do try out issues with such label, and yeah, participate in KVOC. Here KVOC is the best place where you can learn a new language and make the best use of version control. So follow us on Facebook for that, for updates. So, and more, so basically we made a repo where we have all these slides and some advanced resources. Like, we discussed merge, but as someone discussed in chat that there's an advanced feature called rebase. So we have included the simplest things for that. And one more nice feature is something called squash. You have 3-4 commits. All those 3-4 commits can be taken as one single commit. So such advanced things, we have included resources for that. And this slide will be added, so you can check by simply clicking on this thing. So this slide will be added in the repo where you send PR, and check out something called GitHub Student Pack. And yeah, you get many cool free stuff like own domain name and other features of good sophisticated web apps. So check this GitHub Student Pack, you will know what to use. And Hacktoberfest is one thing which you should participate. So again, since this slide will be uploaded in this repo, in the repository itself, you can click on this and check, read more about them. And yeah, just click on them and you'll know more. So yeah, last thing is, please send a PR before you leave, or before feedback from this.
Some people are still facing some issues with the previous error that you're getting.
Sorry for that. I don't know why
just do one thing. Create a new repository with just one file and then ask them to make the...
Delete the fork and refork and clone everything.
Array, wait. Just create a new empty repository with one file. That will be easier.
I worked after I deleted the fork. Thanks. Oh. Yeah. Array, see, the issue was being caused by that some large gigantic file. Don't know how it got added. So basically your fork also had that thing, so that's why issues are coming. Delete that fork. We are sorry that your first fork has been deleted. So really sorry. So yeah, just delete that fork and try again. Fork again, and now you'll have a smoother workflow.
Anish had a doubt that are the changes made in the main repo automatically reflected in the forked repo. So Rakar, can you just open Rakar/GitHub workshop? There will be something interesting there. It's open in the four tabs. But okay.
Thanks. So let's see the commits is the best thing, I think.
Line that says two commits behind.
Let's compare it by opening this also side by side. So you can see the last commit of CosID KGP after merging the pull request which I sent was this commit, merge pull request number 15. But in my copy, that is my repository, the last thing in main branch, to be specific, is this merge 14. So it's this is a commit, two commits ahead, I should say, from this. So because, as I said, main should be used to be in sync with the original repository, this is the original repo, and your main branch should be in sync with this main branch. So you have done that on your machine. Sorry, wrong one.
Let's actually just ask them. So you have commits that are on your machine, but not on GitHub. And those commits are the ones which came from upstream. So what will you do to make sure those commits are on GitHub as well? Could someone just type in the chat that what will you do if you have commits that, and those commits came from somewhere. You either created those commits or you pulled from upstream. They came from somewhere, but how will you make those changes on GitHub as well? Could someone just type it out in the chat?
I think let's not delay it. Let me tell it. So yeah, changes are on your machine, but not on GitHub. So you push changes to the GitHub. So git push and the link, which is obviously substituted by the remote variable, which is rakar/causeidkgp is my copy, and it's represented by origin. So I want to push push to this link, this repository. So I write origin because I want to push to this repo and the branch name. So now if I refresh, the commits have been updated. So this is how the cycle is. Here is the main repo, has a main default branch, and you have a copy of it, you clone it, you come to a new branch and experiment it, you push to your copy and send a PR, and once your PR has been merged along with other PRs in this repo, you want those changes on your machine, on your personal copy too. So you want those changes on your personal copy. Now there are two of your personal copies, one on GitHub and one on your machine. So now, as I said, you want changes from this repository to your machine first. So for that you do git pull. As I said, the original repository is by this remote variable, which is upstream. Git push pull upstream and the main branch. Then after it says already update because it's up to date, and after this there is one more personal copy which is not updated, that is your GitHub personal copy. This is personal copy on GitHub. So what you do, you now push to your this repository, git push origin main branch. Again, it should say up to date. So I think the main thing you need to worry about is these two things: pushing to your personal copy to send a PR by git push origin experimental branch name. And one more thing, what you need to worry about is updating the changes on the default branch of original repo to the ones on your machine by git pull upstream main or the default branch name. So like I said, let me run through this again if it's not clear. Personal copy by forking, cloning, pushing to your code base after fixing the bug, sending a pull request. So I think this part is main, like git push origin, the experimental branch name. What is not in this slide is how you update after causeidkgp has updated, has a bug free code. Now you can move to the main branch on your machine by git checkout main, which you are already in main, and then pull the changes from this repository. So yeah, open to doubts, you can ask more.
Subankar has a doubt that where to push in my GitHub repository or cause. So now see, the thing is that to the cause repository you might not have even push access, because if you clone the cause repository and make changes, you will not be able to push. It will say access denied because you are not part of the cause ITKGP organization, which is why this concept of forks comes in, that you take that code base which is in cause ITKGP, you make your version of it, which is your username, in my case mukul-mehta/repository, and then you work on your own version of it. You push to your branch. Everything here is happening between you and your repo. You make changes, you experiment, you write tests, you do whatever. You make everything on your username slash your branch. But when you make a pull request, you make a pull request to the original repo, which is cause-itkgp/main. So you do things from your repo, your branch, to cause-itkgp main. So remember this, that you rarely will have push access to the original repo. You will only make a pull request there.
Shubham,
two pull requests. If anyone's stuck somewhere, you could just ask us directly.
Yeah, Shubham, since you're pushed to your repository, open that page on GitHub. It shows you an icon like I showed previously. Press on compare and pull request, and yeah, that's it. Yeah, at least our minimum is to help you send PRs, which is a main part of being contributing to open source. So we want that to be cleared, and we are okay to help you with that to any level. So yeah, please help. Please ask if there is any trouble anywhere. Like
Rakar, have we have some discussion on Hacktoberfest?
Hacktoberfest, not so deeply, but yeah, anyone can summarize if you wish.
Samajit, are you speaking or?
No, if you want, please go ahead.
Okay, so like there is an event, month-long event going on called Hacktoberfest, where you can basically send in pull requests to open source repositories, and if you get 4 pull requests approved by the owners of that repository, or like there are some specific criteria to be satisfied for those pull requests, you can get a free t-shirt, or like you could also select the option for planting a tree. So this happens every year. It is a remote event. So you could just go to Hacktoberfest website. Can someone just like
screen share kar do? Yeah, and nahi, you do it na. Achha, theek hai. What do you want me to do?
Can you go to the Hacktoberfest website?
Okay, wait.
Arre, wait, just
ho gaya abhi. Right. Hacktoberfest. This is the website. Our event kit QR.
So like Hacktoberfest is a good way to get started with open source. Like you could make your first 4 PRs, and just like for the sake of getting a t-shirt, but still you will learn quite a bit about how to go about making pull requests, like speaking to maintainers and stuff. So yeah, you could participate in Hacktoberfest.
Like we just mentioned, a good place would be MetaKGP repos. You can see the Facebook page MetaKGP and made a recent post.
And I think it's very important to mention that please make meaningful contributions.
Yes.
This year Hacktoberfest was spammed a lot by people making very trash contributions. So you know, someone just adding a comma somewhere, someone adding some random line in the readme somewhere.
An awesome
project. So Hacktoberfest was not opt-in up till now. You could make 4 pull requests to any repository and it could count. And a lot of people did this for getting a free t-shirt, that they would just spam any repository. But Hacktoberfest is now opt-in. So, you know, send meaningful PRs. Your PR now has to be approved by the maintainer for it to count. And only then you'd be eligible to get a t-shirt. So yeah, please make meaningful PRs and keep up the good spirit of the community. Hacktoberfest is actually a great way to get started. If you go to Hacktoberfest website, you will see a lot of good repositories that are looking for first-time contributors. And this is true for, I think, a lot of us as well, that our first contributions were in Hacktoberfest. So it'd be great if all of you would make amazing contributions in Hacktoberfest. That we'd love all. We'd love it to, you know, see that. So Aditi says, could you please elaborate the change? So as far as I know, it's now opt-in. So a Hacktoberfest label has to be added to a repository to make it eligible. And to fix, you know, to make a PR be accepted, you could do 2 things. You could either add a Hacktoberfest accepted label to it, or you could merge the pull request. Only in these cases, it will count on your Hacktoberfest dashboard. So as to the initial PR, I think the PRs made before these changes were made will be accepted after a 14-day period. There's a 14-day buffer period in which, you know, they want maintainers to see if a PR is worth merging. So I think these are the changes, that your PR either needs to be merged or added with a, you know, you should add a Hacktoberfest accepted label to it. The maintainer will do that for you. I'm not sure if this is worth mentioning, but there's a very easy way to get out of Hacktoberfest. You could always open pull requests to your own repositories.
But don't
do that. Okay. Maybe make meaningful contributions to your own repositories even if you are. But it's preferred that you, if I'm making a change, then it also gets counted in the thing. Could you please clarify, Aditi? Could someone else answer? I didn't really understand the question.
No, I think I understand. So you have to make a pull request to count it in Hacktoberfest. Okay. So if you just commit and post, it will not be counted, right? You have to make a pull request.
You can't just push commits and have it count. Please also fill the feedback form.
And like Parth already put up 2 links. There are 2 nice projects or organizations that are looking for contributors. One of them is MetaKGP. The other is Listen to This KGP. And it'll be lovely if you could send pull requests there.
Asking for one more time. So is everyone clear with how to send a PR? We can make a walkthrough once again for a person if some things are not clear.
I think a lot of people have sent, not a lot, but.
So yeah, for the rest who haven't sent, if it's not working, like giving some upside error like I got, delete the fork and.
Only 3 PRs. So could you just tell us if you are even sending a PR? I mean, just for our purpose. So,
just a small PR added bank file for sample request. So these are recent ones. The rest is what in facing, facing issues?
Facing the same error, like the large file thing.
You can delete the fork, or maybe you can send PR to another repo.
I think we have
send the PR to my Facebook clone.
Right. Or we have the previous year's. We have the previous year's
archived, right?
No, yeah, I think that was made private.
Okay.
एक सेकंड, यू कैन कंट्रीब्यूट टू माय रेपो इफ यू विश. इज कैन समवन टेल इफ इट्स द फोर्क और दैट थिंग दैट इज कॉजिंग इश्यूज लाइक अरे नहीं हाँ You can maybe test by sending a PR here if that absurd bug comes that while after forking. So try and fork and try on this PR. Fork and try sending a PR here. So
or wherever you want. I mean, you should just if you want you to send a PR. You could send it to cause, send it to Facebook clone, send it to wherever. And
Git repo.
To the git/git repo.
Okay, sorry. So send wherever you want, but please, our ultimate main aim is you should be able to do this. If not, tell us where you are stuck. We will repeat it or make it clear. क्या हुआ? Hello. Are people there? Or अपन लोग ही हैं? नहीं 13 people are there. अरे 13 people
are. So like the 13 people that are there still now, I think you are more persistent than the others. So I think it will be really great if you can join the MetaGGP Slack. Are all of you there in the MetaGGP Slack?
Or if you're interested, we could like have some advanced topic discussion. Like some of you wanted to learn about rebase and stuff. If you want to hang around, we could do that.
If someone wants to ask doubts, should we just could you enable mic access maybe if someone wants to ask doubts or put them in the chat or I'm pretty sure you'll have doubts, right? I mean, I don't know. I find it very difficult.
Rakar, it's slack.metakgp.com. Oh, who has given the invite link?
Oh, sorry.
Slack-invite.metakgp.com,
I'm opening the Facebook page and checking. yeah, I'll follow this actually, these two. And to join, this. And yeah, follow course also. Even we have open source few repos for Hacktoberfest. Someone is Golang based repo, another is Python based repo. So you can check that out if you wish. Like KVOC repos they have. Is anyone stuck with sending a PR or anything you want to discuss before we disperse?
Someone was asking about fetch. The workshop is officially concluded, I guess. So if anyone wants to leave, you can. But we'll just be having a discussion right now.
For fetch, Rakas, when you pull up that slide, like jo we talked about last night, that image fetch wala, I think.
I remember. Screen still is being shared, right? I think this makes it clear if you want to explain fetch. Ye wala na.
Ye wala. Isko full screen kar de.
Haan, ek second.
So is someone explaining Rakar, Parth, Shubham or
bata do.
Okay, so I was kind of late, but we discussed staging area, right? That what staging area is. Who was gonna discuss? So now this diagram actually tells the difference. I mean, what happens at every stage
of a project. So let's just start from the left side. When you git add, code goes from working directly to staging area and commit adds it to the local repo. So if we just go into some git internals, so what this will does is that when you commit, it will create a new object, a new hash, telling, you know, that will be like a snapshot of the repository at that point of time. So if you see your, there's a folder called .git, which is essentially what Git uses to track everything. If you commit, you'll find it as a new object there with the commit hash. All of this is local. So working directory is your actual directory which you're working in, which in Rakar's case was Git and GitHub Workshop 2020. Staging area is like that shopping cart where you're just adding changes as you see, removing, adding, and doing stuff. And once you finalize things, you commit and you add it to the local repository, which creates a new object. Git push does this, that Git push takes your .git folder, sees if there are any changes against the remote, which in this case is Rakar ka GitHub wala link. It compares the .git folders and then if it finds that there are any changes, it will transfer those changes onto GitHub. I mean, transfer is not exactly the best word, but it will push those changes onto GitHub. Yeah. So that those changes are reflected on GitHub as well. So this is the push side of things, where you add, commit, and push. And in terms of Git internals, there are objects that are created and it will just push those objects, which are again snapshots and hashes. So Git is very efficient, so it won't, so if you change a file 50 times, the size of the Git folder won't become 50 times your original file. So this is why Git is efficient, that it only saves changes and it does not save the whole object as such. So, yeah, and now let's come to Git pull, fetch, checkout, and merge. Okay, let's just come to Git checkout and merge. So Git checkout, you can see there's an arrow from local repo to working directory. And now since your branch is an object in the Git folder, what checkout will do is that it'll apply those changes present in that branch to your working directory. So if you're working in, say, branch main, if you say Git checkout some branch, let's say called bug fix, then it'll find that there's an object for the branch bug fix. It'll take those changes and apply it to the working directory. So your working directory, the code you will see will be of branch bug fix. This is again something that happens on your machine. So yeah, now let's come to the original download, which is fetch and pull. So what fetch does is that fetch downloads the data from GitHub, but does not put it in your working directory. So let's say there's a new commit on GitHub and I just do git fetch origin master or origin main. What it'll do is that your files, if you open a text editor like VS Code, you will see your old version of files. You will not see the new changes there. You will not see any updates to files that have happened, but it will have downloaded those changes. It does not merge them. And the reason we use fetch is that, if there are certain changes that have happened. Okay, before that, did someone discuss merge conflicts or?
No. Merge conflicts, nahi.
Should we discuss merge conflicts?
Let's finish merge in a simplest way.
Okay, so. What git fetch does is essentially, it will only create that new object. It will only create a new commit without even merging. And if you see, this arrow goes from remote repo to local repo only. But if you see what pull does, pull goes from remote repo all the way to working directory. It's like a one-shot thing where it directly applies those changes to your working directory. So if you were working on a file already, and when you git pull, it will make those changes to that actual file. So The reason people do fetch is because of something called a merge conflict. We won't get into what merge conflicts are, but the good thing about fetch is doing a fetch is very clean. Since, you know, you can manually review what changes you want to integrate into your local in your local working directory. This kind of gives you some more control over the changes made, what you want to integrate, what you want to, you know, change, things like that. But you know, for most purposes, a git fetch followed by a git merge will achieve the same effect as doing a git pull. And for most purposes that I have encountered, doing a git pull is usually enough. If you're aware of something called a merge conflict and how to beat merge conflicts. So this is slightly beyond the scope of this workshop, but if someone could maybe personally message us and we could discuss merge conflicts and why git fetch is sometimes a better option. But just understand that git fetch will only fetch those changes and not apply them.
We can show a small demo if you want between pull and fetch. Take 2 minutes. Acha, let's first clarify if there are other doubts. If not,
नहीं, 5 अटेंडीज आ जाए.
अच्छा, फाइन, कूल देन, नॉट एन इश्यू एक्चुअली. तो या एनी अदर क्वेरीज और शैल वी डू अ स्मॉल डेमो ऑफ पुश एंड मर्ज. सो सिंस 5 पीपल आर ओनली देयर, यू कैन अनम्यूट एंड आराम से डिस्कस. यू कैन अनम्यूट, या इफ यू वांट वी विल मेक यू प्रेजेंट इज आल्सो,
और मे बी आस्क मोर क्वेश्चंस. आई मीन और पोस्ट का चैट में
लाइक ये फेच पुल क्लियर कर लेते हैं, लाइक डेमो से क्लियर होगा ना. ये सही है. वी कैन मर्ज लाइक दिस लेटेस्ट PR. मर्ज फिक्स. सो नाउ एज वी डिस्कस द मेन ब्रांच ऑफ द ओरिजिनल रेपो has this latest commit of merge pull request number 21. Now on my machine, if I see on the main branch, I think yes, I'm on the main branch. The latest commit is merge pull request number 15, which is here. Now as we discussed, we can simply do git pull upstream, which is the remote. You can just verify git remote minus v, which is upstream. So yeah, this is the repo, and one thing I can do is git pull upstream and the branch name, or like Mukul Mehta said, because when you pull, there are sometimes a very bad thing in life called conflicts. To avoid that, you can just download the changes but not have them on your code base. So if I do git pull, you have seen that the files are changed. Now let me try doing fetch. Git fetch upstream. Git fetch upstream. So if you see now, the commit history hasn't changed. Like it's still merge pull request number 15, which was previously. But the changes have been downloaded. So if I want to merge it, like downloaded the changes which I got from fetch, I do a merge. Git merge main. Sorry. Git merge upstream. Branch also needs to be mentioned. I'm sorry, sir. So yeah, let's make it clear. I have downloaded the changes from this repo by doing git fetch, but I have not yet applied them to my code base. So to apply them, I do git merge the remote name, which is upstream, and also, which I forgot, which is really bad, I forgot the branch name which I need to update. I am currently in main and I want to update main branch. So git upstream main. क्या हो रहा है?
Upstream slash main main होगा ना? Upstream.
Sorry. हाँ git stream slash main. Sorry. Syntax भूल गया. So git slash upstream slash main. Now if I see git log, the commit is updated. The PR, the code base is updated. See as the last commit is this thing and this thing. Yeah. Sorry. Syntax. I forgot the syntax. I don't do fetch regularly, I do pull only. So git fetch and then git merge remote variable slash branch name. If you are lazy, then just git pull remote variable and branch name. So basically this does the job of git fetch plus git fetch plus git merge remote var slash branch name. So yeah, this is when we did this, that was essentially this command plus this command. So at least a better insight on how pull and fetch are different. Still.
Subhankar has a question that, you know, when I was pushing the updated code, then where to push, main or master, and why? Actually, this question, I mean, this doubt will only come because of repositories before October 2020 and repositories after October 1st, 2020. So, you know, you could do git branch minus v and see what the default branch is and you know, see where you should push. Because before October 1st, the default branch was called master. And due to certain reasons, that was, you know, to remove possibly racist connotations from tech, they renamed the default branch to main. But this is something that GitHub did. And if you create a repository on GitHub, the default branch is now called main. Or you can, in fact, change the name of the default branch. So, you know, if the repository you're contributing to, you know, its default branch is called whatever, you should push to that. So that's something you can only check on GitHub. So if you go to an old repository, Rakan, maybe you could open some old repository, its default branch will still be called master. Very high chances that it will be called master.
Nahi, haan, it's master only.
I mean, unless someone made that change manually.
Nahi, master.
So that is something you have to check. And I don't think there's a way of doing that. But for new repositories and anything you open after 1st October, do git push origin main or git pull origin main or upstream main, or choose main as your default branch.
And Aditi asked regarding after generating API token. So that actually... API token, that depends on what API also you are using, right? So Aditi, do you have anything specifically like a GitHub API token or what are you using? Like, is it like recently, we can give you examples of code by showing code also. So can you please tell like what specifically API token of what API, GitHub API or anything else? Like, hello Aditi. GitHub API token. Okay, nice. We have a cost repo only. So that's why I mentioned GitHub API first. So there's something called Stats API, which we see generally while KVOP, since many people contribute, we want their statistics also. So we use GitHub API token to send API requests to GitHub to get their contribution information. So why, first of all, in API token, why something? So the problem is what, by not having an API token, if there is something like anyone can send a request to GitHub API directly, then many will send continuously requests, and there's a high chances that it will go down soon.
Just a minute. This is not pull request, by the way. This is an HTTP request.
An HTTP request.
Pull request.
It's a HTTP request. Yes. So because we don't want any random person to send, you get something called a token, which you get by registering that. suppose to use for this application called Sevok Stats API, I want access information by making HTTP request to GitHub API. Now, for that I register. There's a some Google form where you can easily generate. I think it's in settings. API tokens. I think here only developer settings, and I GitHub apps. I want to build new app, and here I mention suppose Kvox Stats API and the purpose and the URL and all those stuff. I get a token. Now I use that token in headers of my HTTP request to tell that yes, bhai, it is me who is sending, an authorized person who has registered by filling your form. And GitHub checks that token whether it's matching with the one that has been that is there in their DB or not. And yeah, if it's good, then it gives a reply. So we can show you code or example also. Like this is a generate statistics.py, and HTTP requests are made using something called request library. Made using request library, and wait, and for HTTP request, as I said, we add headers, and this is the header as we want to send. This is the syntax which GitHub preferred in their docs, prescribed in their docs, the token with space with the token that you generated. Now here you expect the token, right? Like generally that tokens are generally long, random, unreadable strings. So here you expect that to be, but it is not a good idea to store your token publicly. So because now I can suppose if I was an outsider, I would use this token and send requests. And now this token might get banned. So a good idea is token is stored in environmental variables that is on your machine. So when what this os.getenv does is it takes from it in environmental variables, there's a variable called GitHub token and it takes that value and uses it. So anything did I miss or not clear? So this is how generally tokens are used. You create by filling a form and you use it in environmental variables like os.getenv. In this is Python case. If it was JavaScript or React, you would process.env. Something, I don't remember the syntax. So yeah, it depends on the language, how you hide your environmental variable. So yeah. So anything, Aditi?
Let's end it right now.
Let's wrap up.
Chalo, only 3
attendees now. So,
okay. Chalo, then it was actually nice.
Actually, the recording went on for 4 hours long, so I don't know if it would be feasible to download it and then upload to YouTube.
Break kar lete, download karne ke baad. अरे लोग 9 घंटे का वीडियो लगाते हैं।